Now, woodlands kingfishers are calling all around us. And let's just take a moment to listen to all the birds rejoicing as a lot of insects will emerge only after rains. And because we've had, oh, there's the European beater that you may have got a flash of flying through the center of the shot. And as you can hear, the birds of Juma are ecstatic with the change in fortune. Finally, we've got some moisture after what has been an incredibly dry spell. Usually this clearing that we are parked in has got a blanket of grass that covers it during these months of the year, but at the moment, as you can see, it is a barren wasteland. Hello, Susie and Kat. You would like to know if this eagle would eat other animals like birds as well. And certainly I think it would. I've never actually seen one feed on a bird, but let me pull out my bird app and see what they have to say about the feeding habits of this bird. Like I said, a lot of the migratory birds that come to South Africa from far and wide, this bird can stretch as far as Turkey, Greece, even further east thereof. So they've traveled huge distances, and it's mainly for these reproductive termites. They emerge in their millions over a regular summer and are incredibly high in protein. So that's why a lot of birds will come here. Let's see what it says here about food for the lesser spotted eagle. It's mostly termite elates of both the harvester termites as well as the fungus-growing termites. It does say, though, that it eats the chicks of recently fledged red-billed quillias and some small rodents and amphibians. So fascinating that in this part of the world, when it is on its summer holiday in Africa, its main source of food and protein will be from these termites. And to give you an idea of how important these are in an ecosystem, it's not uncommon to even have hyena and other larger mammals feeding on these tasty little morsels. I fed on them as well, especially when I was growing up as a kid. It tastes like little kind of peanut butter sweets. Best when fried, but you can eat them raw, wings and all. So good food for us, good food for the animals. And what has Brian spotted? Oh, woodlands kingfisher right here. Well spotted, Brian. And isn't that awesome? I saw Brian twitching, trying to get the camera across there, and I was wondering what surprise he had in store for us. This is a woodlands kingfisher. We might get to see it and hear it call, as other members of its species are calling all around us, or it seems to be hunting. Look at the way it's scanning the ground for any possible prey. Come on, give us a call. And as we wait, hoping that, oh, there we go. Perfect. So patience paid off there. James, oh. James, let's see if it doesn't give us one more. That was the one further away. Come on, one more. Nope. James Dungan, while we wait for this little bird to possibly call again, you would like to know if there was an emergence of a lot of bugs immediately after the rains last night. And yes, most certainly, the reproductive termites were out in full force almost immediately after the rains, coming flooding into wherever there was any artificial light, which naturally is inside your bedroom. The frog chorus was also absolutely spectacular, and I always find it amazing how quickly these animals emerge as well as start vocalizing, capitalizing on the rains that they really need to make the most of, especially in a dry summer like this. So yes, James, there was a lot of bugs out last night. Not as many as I would have expected to see this morning. I was out on tracking team whilst James and Sam were taking you on a sunrise safari, and I'm sure all of you that were watching will agree that Sam did an incredibly good job for his first safari, and it was great to see him enjoying himself taking you guys about. And for those of you who are unaware, he will also be taking another safari tomorrow morning. So if you missed him this morning, don't make the same mistake tomorrow and try and tune in to get a different perspective on this wonderful wilderness that we get to explore. It will be his last drive of his interviews. Hello, Robin. And you would like to know if the migratory birds will all start heading off in roughly a similar time of year. And yes, essentially, I would say yes, but what we need to remember is just like their arrival, which is very staggered, so is their departure. I'm not too sure exactly when these lesser spotted eagles will be leaving. They were one of the later arrivals, at least into this area, but because of the drought, because it is an abnormal year regarding how the weather would usually be here, maybe they have come to South Africa but are elsewhere where there is more bountiful food, because usually you would see more lesser spotted eagles around the Sabi Sands at this time of the year. But understandably, because of the droughts, they have probably decided to use that wonderful function of being able to fly and fly elsewhere in search of food. Some of you may remember, it wasn't too long ago, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, a storm passed over. I think we actually delayed the initial part of the drive, and thereafter, I noticed that European rollers, as well as another species, was it Ammo falcons? I think it was the Ammo falcons. But there was two species of birds that were just flying directly over us in an easterly direction, literally following the rains, because they know what effect the rain does have on insects. So I think there will be a lot of seasonal movements along the migratory birds. The carmine bee eaters are another one that are not nearly as plentiful as they usually would be here. And our bird watching on a whole has not been nearly as good as it would be on a regular summer. That call you may be hearing is a European bee eater. Aha, PK, indeed, this is what you call a bird party, and it's been a long time coming. I really don't think we've actually managed to capture this termite emergence and bird feeding frenzy so far this summer, so I'm very happy that we've got off to a solid start and got this one ticked off, at least for the summer. I'm not too sure what else we're going to do. I'm thinking of maybe taking you guys to the Juma Waterhole to see what's happening across there, seeing as the waterhole camera is down. Apologies for that, but trust me, Alex, our Russian tech wizard, is doing everything he can to try and get it fixed. We are out in the middle of the African wilderness, so sometimes it can take a while to get necessary parts, or merely troubleshoot and understand what gremlins may be causing the tech difficulties, which get this quite intricate and detailed information across to you guys around the world live. So do forgive us, but we are trying our best, or at least Alex is. I wouldn't be much service to him. I'm wondering what to do here. Not easy. Let's maybe continue. I think we've had the best of what's on offer here, and we may find that there are other termites moving or exiting their termitarias on the property, and we may find some other raptors there. While we make our way down the hill to the Juma Waterhole, we'll be there shortly. We're going to send you across to James for a quick update on what his plans are going to be.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is marvelous to be here in the wilderness this afternoon. I forget the date because all days roll into one, of course, but I do know it's a Friday afternoon for us, which of course is also meaningless because tomorrow is Saturday and that's exactly the same as Friday, which in turn is the same as the other days of the week. Now, you're on a live safari, as Scott no doubt told you, in the northeastern corner of the most beautiful country on planet Earth, that is South Africa. My name is James Hendry. On camera today we have David, Say hello, David.
And Johnny.
There we go. David, using the Zulu vernacular there for how are you. Of course, you are unable to answer him at this stage. But should you wish to answer him, please do so on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. You can also use the YouTube chatting thingy bob thing that works there. Good. Now, yesterday we had some marvelous rain, and what I wanted to show you was the fact that the grass has sprouted. Despite the lateness of the growth season would normally be over by this time of the year because it is, of course, late February. We're going into March fairly soon, and that is the beginning of our autumn. So despite the fact that I think the seed bed probably won't sprout, the existing grass plants are certainly putting up a flush of green, which will be a great relief to any of the grazers that are around the place. David, this is a particularly fine piece of grass, and I would like you to taste it and give me your impressions. What do you think, Dave? Sweet?
Slightly minty.
Slightly minty. It is, if I'm not mistaken, an example of Panicum maximum, which is a very important grazing grass in South Africa. It grows in the shade, and it'll quickly put up those leaves for the animals to eat. Well, that's not why it's putting them up, but it'll be putting them up and the animals will eat them. And it's putting up those leaves, of course, so that they can photosynthesize and build up a repository of carbohydrates in the root system and thereby survive the dry times. So very exciting to have had some water. Now, I have been instructed, by the way, this is the reason I'm looking so awkward, that I'm basically too short and therefore need to pull the seat forward and sit up a bit. And that means that the seat is now basically underneath the dashboard and I'm on two or three blankets and my legs will get squished underneath them. So if I look a bit awkward trying to get into the car, that is why. This is the sacrifices, of course, of trying to be on camera and not looking like a dwarf. I'm sure Tom Cruise managed it, but I think they, you know, I mean, when you get to his status, people run around you, not the other way around. Now, let us go to Bivelshoek Dam. It's just up the road here, and we'll see what we can find there. Kirsten, I am plugged in again if you wish to talk to me. I think I can hear you. Please give me a test. Ah, there we go. I can hear her. Oh, Judy, you're in Ohio and we've had that little bit of rain and you want to know if there's any chance of the marula trees giving us a second fruiting. Judy, I think not. I don't think they will. I don't know for sure, but I'm pretty sure that there won't be a second fruiting, Judy. So I think what's... we were chatting about the fruiting trees earlier today and we said the marulas and the sour plums and the white berry bushes have all really failed to produce a decent crop of fruits, which will be of great distress, no doubt, to many of the animals and especially lots of the birds that depend on those fruits. And we will see what happens with the guari bushes. They normally fruit a little bit later. They make some very tasty little red, well, black currant-y type berries. They're not, I'm not gonna lie to you and say that they're delicious, but they're certainly edible. And I saw one guari bush the other day with some berries that were sort of starting to come through. And we've had the rain now, and so maybe they will produce some nice berries for the end of the season. Nice question, thank you, Judy. And Catherine, as you say, it is amazing that the grasses took advantage of such a tiny little bit of rain. For here, 20 millimeters or about an inch is quite a lot of rain in one sitting. So I'm not surprised that they flushed. I think I will be surprised if they continue to flush though. I think their water in the surface layer, unless we get more, is going to dry up very quickly. Now, if you look around us, David, if you wouldn't mind showing us all of the clouds, I think we might be in for a little bit more rain later today, which would be very nice indeed. And certainly a couple of days like this, which are humid, and so therefore not particularly pleasant for the human beings around the place, it's pretty good for the plants because they don't transpire as much. And that blinding sun that hits the earth during the summer with no cloud will obviously cause the ground to dry up a lot faster than it is at the moment. So this will allow the water to really sink in there and give us a good watering. I'm not really sure what I'm hoping to find at Biffle's Hook waterhole, other than, there we go, we're through the bumps, other than just to see what else has developed. I was amazed to find this morning that because there is a little bit of water there, that wood sandpiper that we've been looking at throughout the season, while there was water there, has returned. How it knew to come back there in the dawn light this morning after being away some other watering point for goodness knows how long is beyond me. I think it's absolutely astonishing. They obviously know that after rain there will be puddles and things that they can go to, and maybe they take off at first light and fly about the place and go to regular haunts where they used to go. The other thing I wanted to show you, this is so cool. Check this out. This morning I showed you these plants, the baboon's tail, Zero Phyta retinervis, and I showed you leaves all of this kind of yellow color. And I said that they'd been brown the day before, which they were, and then they were yellow this morning, and all of them have turned green in less than 24 hours. They've all suddenly come to life, and I find it absolutely astonishing. And that'll be pretty good grazing for, I guess you'd call it browse, because they're not grasses, but they'll be pretty good browse for lots of browsing animals, especially the elephants. I think the elephants quite like to go and pick the individual leaves and eat them. Right, let's head across to Scott, see what he's doing. He's with a Jacobin cuckoo.
Well, this is an animal that we do not get to see perched out in the open like this very commonly. I think it's because it's ashamed of their parasitizing nature, allowing other birds to raise their young. Sneaky critters, this is the Jacobin's cuckoo. And like I said, it will lay its eggs in other birds' nests, and specifically other birds' nests. In this case, it will be the bulbuls. So in this area, we mainly get the dark-capped bulbul, which used to be called, I think, also the yellow-vented bulbul at some stage. Usually fruit-eating birds that they will specifically target to lay their eggs in their nests. And because of that nature, they don't usually hang around. So I thought we'd take that opportunity to get you a good view of it. And possibly another bird for a lot of you guys to add to your bird lists. There was nothing at the Juma waterhole, so we didn't decide to call you back to just see a few terrapins' heads bobbing about. I'm told it is working on some platforms. I think possibly wildsafarilive.com. You may be able to see an upside-down image of the waterhole camera if you are desperate. It's just not playing on the regular site, I think, that it would normally play on. So that's an update there for you guys. Hello to Victor, who's obviously planning a trip out to the Sabi Sands in May and would like to know if there are going to be any kingfishers here to welcome you. Yes, there certainly are, but sadly, I think by then, the woodlands kingfishers and African pygmy kingfishers would have headed back further north to equatorial Africa. Oh, we're in for a little treat here. Brian, next to that little clump on this, I can't really see, but there's there you can see a little something, right on the end of my finger. Ta-da! A foam nest frog. How cool is that? I'm going to jump out so that you guys get an idea of how big it is. Sadly, we won't be able to get much closer to it. Also called a grey tree frog, foam nest frog. They've got a couple of names. Sorry, Victor, just back to your question quickly. Yeah, the two kingfishers that are migratory, that do come here for our summer months, aren't going to be here. But there will be others, the malachite kingfisher, if we get more water. Hopefully they rely on water. The brown-hooded kingfisher, pied kingfisher, as well as the giant kingfisher. I'm not sure why we don't see more striped kingfishers up here. I remember seeing more on the Sabi Sands, but that is another one you could see. Let's go and have a closer look at this frog. These are the ones that build those big foamy nests over water holes that we would have seen from time to time. Oh, no, I don't want to shake this knobthorn tree too much. I was hoping to be able to climb up it. I still may be able to take a chance here. No, I'm going to wobble the frog too much. But I'll try and get my hand next to it to give you an idea of size. I mean, quite a decently sized frog, a lot bigger than the painted reed frog that Brian spotted the other day. Oh, I'm snagged in the tree here now. Lots of hooked thorns in the knobthorn acacia. And it's interesting that this frog has decided to make itself such a light shade. It's a fairly cool day, so I would have thought it would have made itself a bit darker. But obviously, it knows what it needs to do regarding thermoregulation and keeping the right temperature. Let's hope that a few more puddles and ponds do fill up over the coming weeks so that these frogs can effectively try and raise some more young. Fascinating that there's this frog just existing out in the middle of the dry vegetation where naturally you'd expect it to always be around ponds. Not the case. James has just found a wonderful bird of prey, so rush on over to his vehicle.
Now, to my eternal discredit, everyone, yesterday somebody said they wanted three birds on their list. Obviously, I can remember the birds, but I cannot remember your name. It may have been Carol, maybe Carol. You wanted a crested barbet, a magpie shrike, and a gymnogene or African harrier hawk. I can give you the third one. We gave you the first one yesterday. I'm not a long-tailed shrike, I don't think, but there is the gymnogene sitting there. And he was feeding on the ground here, I suspect very strongly, feeding on the same thing that those lesser spotted eagles were feeding on when you were there with Scott. Now, they will normally eat nestling birds, stealing them out of the tree hole, sticking that double-jointed intertarsus, which is a fancy way of saying an ankle that bends both ways. They'll stick that into a tree and pick out the little chicks. Now, it was Vernie, that's right. It was Vernie who wanted to see the gymnogene. Vernie, there you are. It's now called an African harrier hawk, which is profoundly less romantic sounding than gymnogene. Well, there he is. And he was on the ground here, and he leapt up off the ground. And there are a whole lot of hornbills here. There are some drongos, which tells me that there is an emergence of termites over here. Let's see if we can get a bit closer. Oh, this is marvelous. Look at his beautiful yellow face, which turns red when he's about to mate, which I think is rather appropriate. Isn't he lovely? Now, what I meant by double-jointed intertarsus, you can see the ankle joint there. Well, what looks like a backwards knee joint is actually the equivalent of our ankle joint. And that bends both ways. So if you can imagine your, well, not both ways so much as sort of more than 180 degrees. So if you flex your foot where you're sitting right now, or standing, or doing whatever it is you're doing, push your toe down as far as you can push it. Now, imagine that you could bend it the same again. That is what that gymnogene can do with that foot, and that's to allow it to stick its foot into tree holes and steal the nestling chicks out. Now, oh, this is amazing. Dave, let's leave the gymnogene for now. There's the drongo. He's going to keep flying around. He's going to keep landing here. Can you see the blackbird there? That blackbird is the fork-tailed drongo. There he goes. Now, there are termites coming out of the ground here, and every time one comes out, he and the hornbills have a little scrap over trying to get it. There he goes. He's trying to pick one off. They hawk insects from a perch. So what he's doing is he's flying down as the termites come out of the ground, catching them and flying off again. And the hornbills, of course, are not as fast in the air. They'll be trying to feed on the termites off the ground. And it looks like they've been here for some time. I can't see any obvious emergences of the termites, so maybe it's almost over. Incredible. The Gymnogene is still there. So let's just try and see if we can't get slightly closer. I don't know that we will. Not normally this confiding, they'll normally fly away. Tim, as you say, that Gymnogene is a good-looking bird, a very good-looking bird indeed. And definitely was sitting on the ground here eating termites. I'm just going to have a look around on the floor to see if I can see where they're coming from. I can see a few flying up off the ground. But I can't see exactly. Oh, there they are. That's where they're coming from. Okay, I've spotted it. All right, everybody, have a last look at the Gymnogene. I'm now going to get out of the car and show you where the termites are coming from. Okay, Vernie. Tick him off. You got him. He's still there. Right, over here.
Where was it?
Somewhere over here he flew out of. I can't actually see it anymore. But what? Oh, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Dave? I don't know how much of a picture you're going to get here, but there's a hole in the ground and there are a whole lot of little soldier termites, not soldier, worker termites, who've opened up this hole. And out of it are going to come those alates, the flying termites, often misnamed as flying ants, which they aren't, of course. They are flying termites, which are unrelated. Then, all the way around here, you can probably see these black things here. Those are ants, and those ants are called drop-tail ants, and what they are doing is stealing termites. So they'll be carrying off these workers one at a time. Here comes an emergence. You see the flying ant? Here it goes. Watch. Just being helped out by the workers, and off he goes. Ha! That was an ant biting me. A thieving ant that is trying to steal the termites. And there goes another termite. Flying, come on, fly. That one's missing a wing. So I wish we could bring the camera here. These ants are darting in, grabbing a worker termite and then devouring it and walking off with it. They've kidnapped, goodness gracious, they've kidnapped an alate. Look, here we go. Let me show you quickly and then I'll put them back. It's gonna bite me, this thing. Look at that, see? They've kidnapped, that's a flying ant, or flying termite. They've taken off its wing. See, he's carrying off the wing. And then these ones will start to bite and kill the flying termite and then take it back to their nest. They're very confused because they suddenly find themselves suspended in the air. They're gonna start biting me soon, so I'm gonna put them back on the ground.
Link to Scott for the
home. Marvelous. Okay, let's head back across to Scott. I'll see you at Bivilsook Waterhole.
Now, initially, I thought this red-billed hornbill had a kill in its beak. Oh. But it didn't. It had some nesting material. I'm trying to watch where it's flying to. Oh. I think I may have. Yeah, okay, we got it. We can keep an eye on it. Let's go. So it's got some nesting material in its beak, and I'm guessing that it's building its second nest of the summer. Quite a few birds will raise more than just one clutch of chicks per season. Oh, it's just in this big leadwood tree to our right, Brian. Wouldn't it be nice if we could establish where exactly it is building its nest? It's just up over there, just above my finger, I think, Brian. Oh, there it goes. But we still might be able to work out where it's building its nest. Oh, no. It disappeared into the lower-lying vegetation. But happy to see and report that the hornbills are still actively raising more young, or at least attempting to. Good stuff. That was some mud and in its beak, and they will use mud to enclose themselves into a cavity in a tree, and they just basically leave a very thin coin slot that their beak, or the female's beak, can fit out of and the male's beak can fit into to deposit food to her while she is stuck in there for over a month, while she incubates and then helps initially raise the chicks till a decent size. After about 10 to 14 days of them hatching, she too breaks out of the nest, reseals them in there so that it's difficult for animals like snakes or mongooses to get in, and then thereafter she will break out, like I said, and help the male in feeding them enough. Now what's interesting is that sometimes the females will also undergo a full feather molt whilst in the incubation chamber in the nest. So it's kind of part work, part pleasure, kind of semi-health spa vibes in there, getting a full makeover. She obviously doesn't need any feathers while she's in there. Good. Now, I'm hoping that our signal is going to be strong today. We intend on doing a Mulwati riverbed cruise. We're about to drop into the riverbed here, and I don't think anybody would have driven it this morning. Therefore, we're gonna have a very clean riverbed to drive through with no prior vehicle tracks. Hello, James Bear. You would like to know, what do the frogs do during the drought in order to stay moist enough to survive? It'll all depend on the individual species. The painted reed frogs and foam nest frogs, or grey tree frog that we saw now, I think will just position themselves in areas, or within cavity trees. But as far as I'm concerned, below the ground, the mucous membrane that will keep them dry. And other frogs, like the African giant bullfrog, they will go underground. So they spend time underground in order to keep dry. So like I said, it does depend on the individual species. I think a lot of the aquatic frogs may also bury themselves in the mud, or in holes near the mud, or near their water sources that would typically be full of water. So yeah, I think a lot will depend on the individual species. Some do not rely on aquatic lifestyles or aquatic habitat, whereas others do. And I think that obviously will affect the way they behave during the drier months. Welcome to the Mulwati riverbed. And I'm gonna put my feet up and just enjoy the cruise now, because the beauty of it is that you don't really need to steer the vehicle if you put it into low range, and it can enjoy let me actually put my feet here, it's a bit more comfortable. And it's following, even though there's not clear vehicle tracks, it's following the older tracks or impressions. So it's the nice way to be able to let the car do some autopiloting while we scan around up into the trees. Could be anything lurking in here. I was thinking last night as I was lying in bed, will we find a python today? Snakes are typically more active after the rain. We were lucky enough to find a boomslang this morning that some of you got to see with James. So anything is possible snake wise and I don't think we've seen any decent pythons so far this summer. OK, Okay. Susie, you are loving all of the smaller critters that are being found today. The terrapins, tortoises, frogs and snakes are ones you'd like to add to your list of the frogs we've already seen. And it certainly is possible. Like I said, a lot of animals will begin to move after heavy rains, especially the reptiles who may have been seeking shelter and now need to head out and dry off in search of a little bit of warmth after being cold in the rain, as they would have been last night. Well, you're in luck. James has already found one of those animals that you're hoping to see. So off you go. We'll see you later.
Finishing. Cool. 2-1.
Right, we're here at Bilbozook Waterhole, and the most interesting thing that I saw, which is unfortunately absconded, was a pygmy kingfisher sitting on a piece of mud the far end there, and some blacksmith plovers around the place, lots of terrapin activity in the water. No mammals have come down here, but that's probably because they heard I was coming, and so they've run away. I will show you a picture of the pygmy kingfisher. I just got out to see if I could get a slightly closer look at him with my deeply aged binoculars, which I hear Scott was very rude about the other day. He said that they were the oldest binoculars in the world. He might be right. But the pygmy kingfisher, which is not a fish eater at all, I spotted in there. K for kingfisher, 268, but just such a beautiful bird that it's worth showing you a picture. There he is. That's him there. Isn't that lovely? Beautiful little bird. Then there is the very similar looking malachite kingfisher, which this one wasn't. And the malachite is a fish eater, and so he might come down here and look for fish at some stage. I haven't seen a malachite here. I know they are found here, though. So that's what's happening here at Biffleshook Waterhole. Not much else, I'm afraid, so I think we'll press on, see what else we can see along the way. No tracks of those lions from yesterday. I don't think they found the Nkuhuma pride on Torchwood this morning, which Brent would have been sad about. And he was on Biffleshook for most of the morning, and I don't think they found any lions there either. So maybe, just maybe, we missed the tracks coming across from last night. I don't think so. I think they're probably headed further east towards the Kruger Park, but that rain would have washed away, of course, all of their tracks. Anyway, on we go. Hello, Susie. You're obviously a budding amateur or possibly a professional herpetologist. And you say you're loving all these frogs and lizards, and you want to see lizards and terrapins and tortoises and other things like that. Well, we'll do our best to try and find them. I would love to see a few more frogs, I must say. I feel that I've been very deprived of frog activity during the course of this year, because we just haven't had any water for the frogs to sit in. And I think this evening, just before we close down, it would be nice to park next to some water and see if we can't get some frog song, which is just a wonderful soundtrack to the low-felt bush evening. But again, have we seen a mammal, Dave?
Not yet.
Not at all. Right. Been out an hour, haven't seen a mammal. I think there's definitely something that I'm, some kind of vibe I'm putting out at the moment. And Cindy, you're a budding entomologist, and you want to know about ladybugs. Do we get them out here? We do, absolutely. We get some exotic species and we get some common indigenous species, very beautiful. I could show you a picture or two when we stop. Let's just get a bit of distance going, and then I will show you some pictures of the ladybugs. And they, of course, eat aphids, and their aphids are abounding at the moment. As soon as we had a little bit of rain, there was a whole explosion of aphids, which we found on some plants 2 days ago. So maybe the ladybugs will come back. Again, though, just like with most of the other colorful insects that really do light up the summer, there have been very few of them this year. Thank you, Susie. Cindy, sorry. Susie's the herpetologist, Cindy's the entomologist. She'll remember that. Well, probably won't, but I'll try. There were some buffalo around here this morning. Seemed to have moved on. I was hoping that they might be at the water. They were not. No, I didn't. Stephen, you're asking about that Land Rover we found this morning, mired in a position that looked like Brent Leo Smith might have been driving it in the middle of the Mlorati drainage line. And no, Stephen, we didn't find the owner of it. I didn't actually look, to be honest. I forgot clean about it until right now. We might drive past there a little bit later and see if it's still there. VM, of course, was of the opinion that we should steal it, cannibalize it for parts, and just sort of deny knowledge. I thought that sounded a little bit like criminal activity, and I suggested we shouldn't do that. Mainly, of course, because it was a Land Rover and an old one. And if you want to spend your life working on a car, get an old Land Rover. VM, of course, is massively skilled with all things technological, and so he is able to do things like that. I need to have a vehicle that works. Now, I know we've seen this chap many times. Can you see the kingfisher there? Sorry, this was just a really nice picture of a woodland kingfisher. We're seeing lots of them, of course. And while I won't be too sad when they go home because of the noise, it's always a good idea to try and appreciate them as much as possible. Let's head across to Scott. I think he's actually looking for that chocolate-coloured Land Rover.
So, we have established that a vehicle has driven along here. You can see the tracks, and of course it was confirmed to us that you guys, or some of you at least, did see an abandoned vehicle parked, I think it was somewhere just up ahead, I'm told. So, let's see if it's still here. I wonder who it was and what happened. It may be an unsolvable mystery. Possibly it could have been Brent with his guests who have both departed today. Brent is headed off on his official leave. He has been on leave, but he's been working during it. And yeah, that's certainly possible. It could well have been Brent with his guests or Aubrey with the other half of their crew. Imagine how much fun they had. They rented out both the camps at Juma, one called Vuyotela and one called Galago. They both sleep 10 people. And they were both within the same kind of confines in walking distance of one another. They would do all their dining together, but 20 friends celebrating a marriage on safari in Africa. Not a bad holiday, I don't think. Hi, Khada. You'd like to know if I've ever seen any water in this riverbed? Well, I can see all the footprints of humans here, so maybe they had a coffee break here. I can also see where the vehicle turned around. So I'm guessing this is where you probably saw that Land Rover abandoned. Yeah, so that'll explain it. Maybe all of the guests hid for fear of being live broadcasted to whoever wants to watch on the world. So they probably ducked for cover. Brent would have been able to pick up the telltale audio of our petrol engines. Most of the vehicles in this area use diesel engines. Khada, I have seen water in this riverbed, but only flowing very temporarily, not for long periods of time. I'm sure many, many years ago, before the surrounding areas outside of the Sabi Sands were not farms, were not highly populated with people. There's a lot of human disturbance, you could say, or just ongoings, which I guess is disturbance to anything natural, between here and the Drakensberg Mountains, which is our main watershed. So we won't be receiving the same moisture in this area as that we would have experienced flowing through the riverbeds many, many years ago. And that's just one of the realities of life, I guess. And as I guess it's an important thing to remember for all of us on the planet, you can keep wilderness areas pristine as you like, but the ripple effects of our behavior outside of these parks has effects. on them. So I guess not wasting water and doing all the right things, recycling and trying as much as possible from wherever you are in the world to be as conservation friendly as possible is going to have effects on these pristine areas around the world. So something just to think about. Now, we are on our southern boundary. The road is called Gowrie Main. And we are going to be heading west along it until we enter into Arethusa, where we are going on yet another search in the hope that we may find the Anderson male leopard. He's only been caught on our Safari Live cameras, I think, 3 times. And we would like to try and change that, give you guys a new leopard to look at. I've got no idea where he is or when last he was seen. I'm just kind of, over the last few weeks, I've been employing the tactic that if we just spend more time in the area where his territory does creep into Arethusa, he doesn't move too deep into Arethusa, but by skirting that western boundary of Arethusa, it's simply just increasing our chances of getting him on camera. That is our plans. We could obviously also bump into Shadow, the female leopard who's dominant in that area, who a lot of you will know. James Richards, yes, you are right. It has been a while since Karula, the mother of Shadow, the leopard we could see across on Arethusa, graced us with her presence. And I believe it was Saturday night last week when Jamie and Brian were doing the first night vision nocturnal drive testing. So I'm not sure if that was the first night, it was a Friday or a Saturday night, but that was the last time we saw Karula. She was snarling at Tingana. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm fairly certain that was the last time she was seen. So what are we today? We also Saturday, so it's been a week. And therefore it's been a week since we've seen a leopard. That's quite a long time, statistically speaking. So maybe today our luck will change. For those of you who are new to Safari Live, we basically see two female leopards, one of which occupies Juma as her territory and the other one that occupies Arethusa as her territory. It's not cast in stone, and territories will fluctuate from time to time, and just like us as humans may frequent a certain restaurant or certain shopping center for a couple of months, your taste may change for various reasons to another restaurant or shopping center for another few months, and it's the same with the leopards. Their lives and movements do fluctuate. In terms of males, we're mainly seeing one male called Tingana. Wondering if we're going to be able to get a view of these parrots that are squawking up in this tree. I pulled out my spotlight hoping that it would have some kind of illuminating effect on them up in the tree there. Those which I thought were the parrots are actually starlings, which we can now reveal as Brian tweaks. Oh, we're in luck, Brian. We're in the wrong tree. The parrot's just off to our left here. So it's right on the top of this left-hand leafy bush at 9 o'clock. There we go, straight in there. Just in there, yeah. There we go, just on the left of your shot. Well done, Brian. So, the brown-headed parrot, it's one we don't get to see very often. Doesn't have the brownest color head, to be honest. I mean, I don't know about you guys, that looks like gray to me. And it's feeding on the four-winged seed pods of this bush willow tree. It's got one in its talons now. And incredibly dexterous parrots with regards to being able to use their feet to feed things into their mouths. Not many birds can do that. Oh, it's just got another seed pod that it plucked with its mouth, and now, again, it's using its foot to assist. Very seldomly will you see birds doing that. Even predatory birds, which do have a similar foot structure as parrots, you'll very seldomly ever see a bird of prey lifting up their food to their mouth, yet parrots can. And it's wonderful that we're not only getting to see it here, but we're getting to hear it squawking as well. Not the largest of parrots, probably about 6 inches in length. And it's the only parrot that we get in this specific area of the Kruger National Park. We get two other species in the Kruger National Park further north of us, the grey-headed parrot and the Mayer's parrot, I think, are the two. Yeah, I've just double-checked in my book. Those are another two we get. The grey-headed parrot slightly bigger than the brown-headed parrot that we're seeing here, but the Mayer's parrot looks very, very similar. Wonderful. We're racking up some birds today that we sometimes go days and weeks without seeing. The cuckoo earlier, the gymnogene with James, and now the brown-headed parrots. Kruger guy, you'd like to know if it's feeding on these seed pods simply because there's not as much fruit around as normal. Yes and no, they will always feed on these seed pods. There's, I guess a seed pod is a fruit in a sense. So even though it's not a fruit to us and doesn't seem fleshy and tasty, to the birds it is. And most fruits, again, will be the transporters of seeds, no different to that four-winged pod. It is a fruit with the seeds within it. All fruits have got the seeds concealed within the fleshy parts of the fruit. It's just that in this case the bird's not wanting to feed on the fleshy fruit, but more so the seed. Don't know if that made sense, but I think it may have. Cool, we're going to send you back to James as we put our foot down on the southern boundary road and get you guys across to Arethusa. See you later.
Now, Susie, a terrapin I have found you. I know it's not a particularly impressive view of a terrapin, but these are marsh terrapins. Now, that's different from the serrated hinged terrapins that we find in most of the permanent water, like the Juma Dam Pan, for example. And these ones only occur in temporary water. And they're distinct from the others, especially, or most obviously, because they have tentacles hanging from the bottom of their chins, which you can't see at the moment because they're not prepared to stick their chins out of the water. They're a bit nervous. Now, an important thing to note about a terrapin, of course, is that firstly, it is a reptile, and therefore, secondly, it is unable to breathe under the water. And a lot of people think of turtles and terrapins as being able to breathe under the water. They cannot. They must come up to the surface for air. They can certainly hold their breath for a long time, especially turtles. I mean, some of those turtles can dive down to astonishing depths, the leatherback, I think even more than 1,000 meters down below the surface. But they must breathe air. They cannot breathe underwater. They are not amphibious either. I think they're rather splendid little things. And that is the marsh terrapin. And this, sort of, if we go wide out on this little pan, is a natural pan that forms in a depression of clay. We're between two slopes, sort of a mini valley. And therefore, all of the small clay particles from the slopes will have flowed down into this area. And because of the clay, the soil will now hold water in this area, and as soon as there's rain like we had last night, a temporary pan like this will fill up. And look how quickly the algae has taken advantage of it. An amazing sort of luminous green colour that has resulted from the rain. And no doubt the sort of dung and bacteria that are in the mud, which have then inspired the algae to these great heights of magnificent coloration. My hat was on at a jaunty angle because the peak was getting in the way. Let us continue. There's some interesting birds diving around up ahead there, and I wonder if they aren't Amur falcons, maybe catching flying termites. Let's go a little bit further up. Hold on, David. rollers. No, well, there are definitely some rollers, but they're all swooping around here. There's a falcon. There's a falcon. There's definitely something going on here. I'm sure it's a termite emergence. I'm just going to stop here.
Hey, look, 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 look.
There it is. Here's another. Oh, sorry, that's a roller. That falcon is coming around. Here, there it is, Dave. Sorry, they're obviously extremely fast. I don't know why it's on its own. There's another one. There's a whole lot more in front of us. And all that, there's an incredible array of birds going around here. Those are oxpeckers catching termites in the air. So I've seen woodland kingfishers, I've seen rollers, we've seen the falcons. They're way above us. There are swallows and swifts looping all over the place. It's almost impossible to show you on the camera, of course. It's all happening so fast. Anyway, we're going to sit here for just a little bit, and I'll show you a picture of the falcon that we were looking at. And the most amazing thing to me is that these falcons catch the birds. They catch the, not the, the birds, they catch the insects in their feet. And then, once they've done that, they feed them into their mouths mid-flight. So what we were seeing there was one of these chaps, an Amur falcon. Isn't that amazing? Beautiful. And they seem to have disappeared now. They normally occur in very large flocks, and the Brent Leo Smith swears blind the other day that he saw Eurasian hobby, which is a fairly large falcon. I'm just going to show you that too. And that does look quite similar in coloration to the bird that we saw flying around here. But it eats swallows and bats. It doesn't. Oh, it does catch. Much more leisurely when gliding and catching termites when seized. Could it have been the Eurasian hobby? It can be a very special bird to see out here, I tell you what. Wait. Let's drive slowly on and we'll see if it doesn't emerge. The only reason I'm doubting my Amur falcon diagnosis is that they normally occur in enormous flocks. Anyway. Termite emergence is always going to give you some kind of spectacular action. Let's drive slowly along. Look at the oxpecker. Amazing. Now, Larry B, while we drive along hoping to see this termite-eating raptor again, I hope we do. There it is. It's over there. Larry, you want to know about the termite mounds and how they're built. They're built with dung, Larry, with soil. I can't see it anymore, Dave. Dung and soil and saliva, they're rock hard. But the wind doesn't make so much of a dent on them, but water certainly does. Water will eventually erode away the termite mounds. But if they are active, then they're constantly rebuilt all the time by the termites inside. And so they get bigger and bigger. But yeah, water will have an effect. Sometimes they get vegetated, and then the water doesn't have so much of an effect. There's another big raptor up in the tree there. Let me drive around there. Drive through here. There it is.
Oh, stop flying away!
Now, Gaia, while we drive along here hoping to see if we can't spot that falcon again, you want to know the difference between a falcon and a hawk. Sometimes it's a regional description of an animal and sometimes it's a biological one. Out here, we would call the hawks, they belong to a different genus, slightly different genus. The falcons belong to the falcos and the hawks belong to a group called the accipiters. So they're slightly different in biology. The hawks you won't find catching catching insects out of the air. They will be there. No, it's an ammo falcon. There are a few of them. They're not, it's not alone. Dave, it'll pop up there somewhere, sorry. I just want you to appreciate, everybody, how impossible it is for this poor cameraman to try and swing that camera everywhere I happened to point. Okay, we're gonna sit here once more, and I'll show you the difference quickly, Gaia, between what we would call a hawk and a falcon. I think a lot of the birds in the States, for example, are called slightly different names. And for example, you would call a buzzard what we would call a vulture, you would call a buzzard. Now, there are the falcons. They belong to it's the same family, I think, as the accipiters, but their genus is Falco. And I'll just find those. I'll just find the hawks. They actually are, you know what, they're a different family altogether. So there are the hawks. And they belong to the genus Accipiter. A lot of them, most of them. There are a few more of them there. Fascinating stuff, this. I think this is amazing. Heidi, the eastern red-footed falcon, or the western red-footed falcon, and the Amur falcon, which we've just been looking at, don't nest here, as far as I'm aware. They nest in, up in Russia, I think, in the steppes. I think that's normally where you'd find them. And I think they nest in trees. They certainly roost in trees here, and I think they nest in trees where they breed. But they don't nest here because they don't breed out here. Now, they're all over the place flying about. I think we may see a few more during the course of the night. There's a vehicle coming. I'm just going to get out of the road. Marvelous. I hope that was as exciting for you as it was for me. I know that you don't quite have the same view of things as I do. But David did a very admirable job then. Beard. Of course, I'm using a whole lot of terms that are not necessarily familiar to many people. Our beard, you want to know what a termite emergence is. Our beard, a termite emergence is basically the celebration of the termite colony's life. And I really love it when the termite emergences happen. I feel very light of spirit when I see the termites coming out of the ground. And an emergence basically happens. Look, another big raptor coming off the ground. Beard, it is when the alates, the royal termites, are released from the mound and they fly off and they go and start off new termite mounds. That's basically, that's in short, that's what it is. But there it is. And Barb G, absolutely, termites are minute for predators to be catching in the air with their feet, and that's why the skill of those Amur falcons is just so utterly incredible. I think that's one of those lesser spotted eagles that Scott was looking at earlier. It's a pretty shy one though. Just gonna see if we can't spot him again. There he is. Dave, he's on the top of that tree there, you see. About 7 miles away, there's another one flying out towards him. There. Deeply irksome bird. Yeah, the chances of identifying a bird at that distance. We're gonna call that a lesser spotted eagle, and before anyone tells us different, we're gonna drive away. So our beard, let me just be a little bit clearer and more definite about what a termite emergence is. So, what will happen is, in the termite mound, you have the queen. The queen is about 15 centimeters long in the case of a fungus-growing termite mound. That's half a foot. One termite, big. She lays about 20,000 eggs a day. Now, of those 20,000 eggs, some will be workers, some will be soldiers, and some will be royal alates. Now, those alates eventually become the flying termites. They're fed by the workers, And when the time is right, when the soil is soft, they make a special tunnel, a special opening on the mound, the workers do. The soldiers come out and form a guard of honor and outfly these royal elates. They're male and female. They may join up with a termite from their own mound. They may join up with a termite from another mound. And they will then land, and the female will flutter her wings. She excretes a pheromone. The male will land next to her. They'll shed their wings, mate, and then they'll dig under the ground. And that's where how the new termite mound starts. The male will stay small for the rest of his life, but the female, for the rest of her life, which can be 15 years, will be about that big. And that's basically what a termite emergence is. RV, here is Hyena Road. Let's go down here. Not a good road, but the lack of Karula tracks is drawing me ever closer to where we last saw her tracks heading. I get such a feeling of excitement when I see these termite emergences. I'm not sure why. Now, Scott is on Arethusa. He is not alone. He has found some monkeys.
Below this branch to the left, Brian. We're just trying to work out where a little vervet monkey is. I think it's just, if you zoom out a little bit, he's a little bit to the left. There he is, top left of your screen. Perfect. By he, I'm not actually sure. It's a very small one. It could be a she. But it's a sight we don't get to see very often. Vervet monkeys. I'm very surprised to see that this one is evidently alone in this massive torchwood tree. Oh, at least it seems like he's found something to nibble on there temporarily. The rest of the troop could be nearby. He or she is far too small to be alone. And let's carry on and see if we can't find the rest of the troop. We don't have the best view of him or her for now, so we're going to be losing out on too much there. The magnificent Balanites, or torchwood tree, after which the road we're about to turn left onto is named after. This is the most fine specimen of a torchwood tree I've ever seen. Oh, there's a dark chance in Gossorf. We're in luck. It looks like it's going to be feeding on the termites, the termitons. Ah, oh, no. It's landed, though, so we're going to get lucky. We're going to get you a great view of it. The dark chanting goshawk. I know you guys may have seen one the other day with James, and it's a wonderful example of just how much these reproductive aleates provide birds of prey with food, because just today we've seen a whole host of different birds of prey snacking on them. And the ammo falcons evidently have come back into this area, the birds you were watching with James, especially knowing that after the rains there is going to be a bounty of food emerging from the ground. Guess no different from this dark chanting goshawk. Come down and feed. I can't, it just, there's a termite mound just below it. Oh, there are termites ejecting themselves from it. But you may find it's already eaten its full. But in that little termite mound in the foreground there are a few winged elates heading out in search of a partner, and then they'll start their own colony. You can possibly hear some other birds calling. It's a whole flock of European bee eaters somewhere. I can't see them, I can just hear them. But I think they've just flown off a little bit too far for you to hear. All that, are they starting up again? How intense is the bright orange legs and beak of this bird? Awesome. Claudia. You would like to know why the reproductive termites will wait for the rains before they emerge, and I think it's so that when they do find a partner and a mate, they have soft ground in which to excavate, moist ground that is easier for them to dig into. and therefore start their royal chamber with relative ease. So that's my theory. They need rainfall to soften the ground in order for them to... Basically, what happens is with the winged reproductive termites, they'll fly for a short period of time, maybe only just a couple of hours. Thereafter, they will land, shed their wings. The female will release a scent pheromone, and the males will follow closely behind the female. So you often see two, one following the other. Once the female finds an area that she's happy to start the rest of her life in, she will obviously, in conjunction with the male, excavate a few centimeters below the ground, and that will be the beginnings of the royal chamber. She will metamorphosize into a large, fat, egg-laying machine that is capable of punching out 30,000 eggs every single day of her life, thus keeping the termite mound well populated with workers, soldiers, more reproductives for future summer seasons. And what an intricate and interesting phenomenon termites are, and what goes on underground. They process huge amounts of vegetation every year, recycling it back into the ecosystem. And also, in repayment for all the food that they feed on, they give back huge amounts of protein in the form of these reproductive termites. Oh, off goes the goshawk. Good. So termites aren't very popular amongst humans, because they eat our houses, our wooden verandas, tables. They're a bit of a nuisance to us, but that's only because we've evolved to no longer fit in with natural ecosystems. They do provide an incredibly important function to natural habitats, just not our habitats. European bee-eaters, I think possibly even carmine bee-eaters flitzing about here. We're in luck. This is going to be awesome. There's obviously a lot more reproductive termites emerging from this termite mound on our right, and there are carmine bee-eaters everywhere. Come on! This is going to be so awesome. Look at them. They're flying around wildly, catching these reproductive termites as they emerge. The adults have got a much brighter pink coloration than a juvenile that you can see there. Brian, maybe if we just pan across onto the actual termite mound now, we'll get to see a bit of their aerial displays. There's a youngster trying to beg from another. And they're flying around, all catching prey just in this area. So let's just wait a second here. There they go. They're very, very quick, so it's going to be very difficult for Brian to stay with one of them, but I guess it's up to you, Brian, whether you want to try and stay with one as it swoops off the branch or stay in the kind of kill zone. Oh. Not an easy business, but let's take some gambles here. Maybe if Brian does manage to keep the camera on one for long enough, we'll be able to do a slow motion clip to see how exactly efficient they are at catching their prey on the wing. They are unbelievable pilots. Oh, well done, Brian. That was close. I'm not sure if we got the actual kill there. Let's try one or two more. This is going to be worth hanging around for, because they are such good pilots. Come on. Their call is fairly similar to that of the European bee-eaters. I can hear them. The European bee-eaters usually tend to feed higher up in the sky. Oh. You'll probably find they've just eaten themselves into a semi-coma here. They don't look comatose, but there is so much food around that they literally probably need to take breathers from feeding. Brian, there's another bird that just kind of popped into the frame there. Let's see if it doesn't come and land next to the bee eaters again. It was a violet-backed starling, another incredibly colored bird. It was hopping around on that same branch earlier just as we were arriving. Eric Moore, precisely, you're 100% correct. This is a wonderful sighting of kind of how everything is so interconnected and how effectively the food chain does work in this natural habitat. And happy to be sharing a sighting like this with you. Like I said, it's something that we haven't been able to enjoy since the summer rains started falling. Hello, Gracie, who is one of our youngest yet most seasoned safari goers. Gracie's joined us on lots of adventures, and Gracie just mentioned that she's very happy that she doesn't have to get fed by her mom regurgitating food into her mouth. And you're right, Gracie, there are lots of things that we as humans should be grateful for. That is one of them. I hope everything is okay, Gracie, and you're enjoying these bright pink birds. They're not as pink as they usually are. Maybe it's because of the drought. They haven't got as much tasty food, and therefore their colours aren't as bright as normal. Speaking of bright birds, though, I would like to try and show you this violet-backed starling. Oh, you've got a nice gap there, Brian. Look at the colours on this bird. This is even in overcast weather. Imagine if the sun was shining on it. Like most starlings, it would glow brightly in the sunshine. Well, it appears like these beaters have had their full here. So, like I said, let's carry on and see if we can't find some other termite mounds and some other birds feeding on them. We haven't quite made it to Arethusa yet, but we are getting close. So the next time you see us, we will be there. But for now, you're heading back to James.
Just excuse me, everybody. Well, don't excuse me. Come with me. I'm just staring around the side of this bush here. I saw something very odd flying out of the tree. It looked like... Well, it looked like a woodpecker that had eaten a very large green apple and been colored by it. That, of course, is totally meaningless. A redhead, I'm sure it's just a woodpecker with its feathers fluffed out, perhaps. Anyway, we'll carry on. Can you see? I mean, it's just amazing the effect that the termites are having on the area. And you know, I've yet to see a carmine bee eater this season, which distresses me greatly to the core of my being. But our plan from here is to go to Treehouse Waterhole and see what we can find there. Where are you, you strange thing? Anyway, so it goes. Nothing at the Juma Dam Pan at the moment. And word on the street on the wireless is that the Nkuhuma Pride is on Torchwood. So we won't be going to see them this afternoon. But with any luck, they'll pop back to the west, i.e. Vuyatela, tomorrow. I don't know why I failed to see any carmine bee eaters. I think it's deeply unfair. Thank you. know, Gracie, you say you knew that my dance would produce rain. Well, I don't know that it was me, Gracie. Of course, I've done two dances and they haven't made any rain. But Dave and Sam have never done a dance before, so maybe because they helped me, we had such good rain. And you say that you knew that dancing would bring joy to the animals. Well, I hope it did indirectly. I think a lot of animals are very frightened by our silly dance, but I'm glad you enjoyed it, and I'm really glad we got some rain as a result of it. Well done, Dave. I did re-find that falcon, by the way. It was definitely an ammo falcon. So it wasn't that Eurasian hobby. Heading up onto quarantine clearings, and then we'll head down towards Treehouse. Now, Ben, you've been watching for a while, clearly, and you want to know that the lions have settled down after the takeover. Now, Ben, before I answer, let me just give a quick bit of background for those who perhaps don't know what we mean by the takeover. A little while back, I think it was probably around, it was just the end of winter last year, so July, August time, five male lions from the north came bumbling into this area and they chased out the incumbent kings, the Matimba males. Now, although they were much smaller and younger than those Matimba males, there were five of them. And they were filled with the exuberance of youth, and they took over the Matimba scarpet off down to the south, and the Birmingham boys took over this area. But as with all lion takeovers, it's never a smooth process at all. There's always a kind of period of attrition where some of the pride members will be killed, and there's a lot of chasing and counter-chasing that goes on. And during the course of that time, the Nkuhuma pride lost three lionesses. So they were reduced from eight down to the present five. Now, since that time, in fact, very recently, and it's how we know that things have settled down, those females have been mating now with the Birmingham boys. So the Birmingham boys have established themselves in this area. They've mated with the Styx pride to the south. They've mated with the Nkuhuma pride here where we are. And so things indeed, Ben, have settled down substantially since the Birminghams took over. And for a long time, I mean, for 3 or 4 months, there was real mayhem. The Nkuhuma pride avoided the males. In fact, they disappeared for a long time into the Kruger Park. They weren't seen for a few months. And then slowly they were kind of easing their way back into this area. And we were seeing other lions coming in from all over the place. For as the Birmingham boys sent the Matimbas scuttling, so the Matimbas sent the males where they are now settled, scuttling all over the place. And there was great lion upheaval, which was tremendously exciting. But things are settling down, and so we're hoping for some more regular lion sightings as a result. I haven't seen those Styx Pride members probably, I think, since Jamie arrived, and Jamie arrived just after I did, so sort of also since midwinter last year. Still very dry. As we go through this next little drainage line or stream here, what you will see is a pump house which has had the pump taken out of it. And this pump, of course, used to, and for many, many years, supplied Inga's camp, which is where some of the staff live, and I think one of the lodges, actually, as well. They've had to find another place to pump water from because things have got so dry. And I don't think that this 1 inch of rain that we had yesterday is going to make an enormous difference to the water table. Anyway, we have a brief reprieve and we'll enjoy it while we can. And I don't think that this particular area that we're in now got as much rain as the area around Biffleshook last night. And it has been amazing to me to notice how isolated and the rain has been. Here's the old pump house, and that is from whence our water used to come. No more, no more. Also, we're tracking Karula around here 2 days ago, but we didn't find her. Ah, now, Maurice, very, very good question. Many of you will have watched African wildlife documentaries before and seen great vast swathes of grassland plains with the odd tree sticking up and a cheetah maybe lying in the grass plains on a termite mound overlooking the area. And so when you tune into something like this and you come to the Sabi Sands, you think, well, hang on, this wasn't what it looked like on TV. And that's fair enough comment. We do have some grassland areas, Maurice, but the Sabi Sands is largely underlain by granite soils, and these granite soils produce this kind of vegetation. And this vegetation would be called sort of broad-leafed woodland. And we do have some open areas, but further to the south of the Sabi Sands, what you find is something called gabbro, which is a different kind of rock, which produces a different kind of soil, which in turn produces much more open land. So not quite the same as those East African plains, very different kind of landscape, and therefore a very different suite of species, antelope species and other species that live here. And so we're in East Africa, you would have those giant herds of wildebeest and zebra. You probably wouldn't have nearly as many nyala and kudu and duiker and bushbuck and antelope like that that are predominantly browsing species and therefore can't survive on grass. There's another great big raptor flying in the sky there. I don't know if it's going to come this way. Now, Pamela, while we watch this bird, I think it's a Wahlberg's eagle. It is, and it is also enjoying the termites, you know. Mm-hmm. Pamela, you wanted to know about whether we've had enough rain to make the vegetation more juicy for the elephants and for the other animals. Well, juicy-ish, I suppose, but certainly not juicy to the point of it being summer vegetation, but there is a nice green tinge to the vegetation. Now, what I'm going to ask you, Kirsty, to do is to turn up the sound, because there's a frog calling, and it's the same frog that Scott showed you earlier, and I don't know if you heard it call, but you'll hear it call now. It stopped. How typical. They're making it just as very subtle quack, quack, quack. That's all they do. But you saw the foam nest frog or grey tree frog with Scott, and that's what's going on there. So as soon as there's a bit of water, a couple of puddles, so those foam nest frogs or grey tree frogs will come out and make their nests. Make hay while the sun doesn't shine. Robin, you're in Maryland, and we were talking about the frogs there, and you want to know if we have toads here. Yes, we do have toads. Now, remember, toad and frog are terms that mean different things to different people. Very strictly speaking, toads belong to a genus of amphibian called Bufo, B-U-F-O. I've always quite liked that word, Bufo. Say that a few times, makes you feel light of spirit. And the rest of the amphibians that look like frogs would be called frogs. Now, we have a number of toad species here. The most common is the eastern olive toad. We get red toads here. We get northern pygmy toads. I think we get the odd sand toad here as well. And when we get to the water here, I will show you some pictures of them. I love them. If we can find one, I'd be extremely happy. I find them most enjoyable to watch. But the rest of them would be described as frogs. We had a wonderful frog sighting 2 days ago with Brian and I. Brian had an incredible spot. We drove past a bush, and hiding underneath a leaf was an aestivating painted reed frog. And by aestivating, I mean that it was in a kind of dormant state, trying to avoid the drought. And that very night, it did rain on us, of course. Was that yesterday? It must have been yesterday. Here we are at Treehouse Waterhole, where there is actually water, which is marvelous. There isn't much drinking that water, of course. We did find some buffalo, by the way, while you're away, just in case you thought that we haven't found any mammals at all. We found some buffalo, but Kirsten rejected them in favor of the carmine bee eaters. I don't really blame her. Onto the wall here, and we'll see what's happening with the frogs. So, let's just look over the water here, and I'll get out the pictures of the toads and froggies. And we'll listen out for some of the birds calling. There are lots of terrapins in here as well, of course. You'll just see their heads poking out. Right, so where are the toads? Here they are. All right, here are the toads. And there is the eastern olive toad. And he's not very big, he's probably about that large, about 3 or 4 inches across. That's a very common one that we get here. There is the red toad, which we find here too. That's him there. The northern pygmy toad we get as well. Magnificent little fella. He's tiny. He's only about that big. That's a life-size picture of him. He's about 1/2 inch across. Amazing thing. And that's probably about all the toads that we get. Then we get lots and lots of different kinds of frogs. Marvellous. Just none of them here at the moment. You can hear the dove calling. That's the orange-breasted bushrike. There just does seem to be a bit of excitement amongst the birds. I think also, did you hear those birds calling? Them Morocco sunbirds, beautifully black and violet and green and red colored sunbirds. But I don't think we're going to see them. I think they're a bit far away. All right, let's head across to Scott. He's on Arethusa. Find out what he's got there, and we will continue along our way and try and find a mammal.
Hello, little Zebby with your muddy hooves. Looks like it's got little black socks on. And I wonder where exactly it was playing in the mud. Maybe it was just running around with absolute joy and excitement, as a lot of herbivores will do after rain. Oh, there's Mommy. You can see how she wags her tail. She's got a thick vertical black stripe between her rump, indicative of a female. There's a leaf perfectly blocking it now. Although, no, there's a little gap. The stallions will lack that vertical black kind of 1.5-inch stripe. A lot of zebra around at the moment, so that is, I guess, one of the benefits of the droughts. I don't remember there being this many zebra last summer. And they're obviously preferring it here to last summer because it's not as thick as it ordinarily would be. There's a lot more short grass for them to snack on. Can't get a little gap here of the mother and the foal. We are now across on Arethusa. I've got an update from the guys. There's not too much going on that they know of yet. That's not to say that there's nothing interesting happening here. And interestingly, nobody has driven the roads that we have driven so far, not even this morning. I can see they are still perfectly cleaned after the rain, so clean slates. And there's nothing better than driving down a road you know for a fact that nobody has driven down, because there could be all manner of action right next to us, like in this marula tree right on the side of the road here. We could drive along and have a leopard dangling off this branch that nobody has discovered. So there are lots of roads that still need to be explored, and that is our plan. Rocky night, sadly no updates on Mr. Anderson as of yet. I didn't specifically inquire. I try and keep radio comms down to a minimum. And I'm happy to just keep that as an element of surprise. It would obviously shatter our hopes and dreams if we knew he was elsewhere. So by actually not knowing exactly where he is, it can keep us in a more positive mindset. This looks like it could be a stallion I'm not too sure yet, though. I can't make up my mind. It doesn't seem quite big enough, but maybe it's a young stallion that's still tolerated within the herd, offspring from last year, maybe. For me, the best way to tell is the view from the rear, just like I showed you with that female now, with that vertical. Oh, no, it is a female. There we can see, hopefully, a bit of a vertical black stripe. Yeah, so it is a female. And it'll be interesting to know how much the vegetation or taste thereof has changed, even since the small amounts of rainfall that we got last night. I think it would have had an immediate effect. The grass would have definitely absorbed it, and therefore will hopefully be a little bit more juicy and tasty than normal. A welcome reward for the herbivores who've really been battling it out so far this summer. Michigan, you are astounded by the fact that the soil is so barren, and mentioned that centuries of animals depositing their dung here, you would have thought would have had more of a positive effect on the states of the vegetation entirely, but we could dump all the fertilizer in the world over the Sabi sands, or could have at the beginning of the summer, but without water things will not grow. And I guess that's all it comes down to, the fact that we are deep into a drought, on top of the fact that last summer we didn't get nearly as much rainfall. We basically got half the forecast or regular annual rainfall last summer, together with hardly any. We probably have had a fifth of what is supposed to be achieved annually so far this summer. And those two facts combined is the reason why nothing is growing. This would naturally be a thick green blanket of vegetation. Look, maybe not out of every square inch of soil, but anything sprouting up would have a blanketing effect, you could say. So even though it may not be growing out of every square inch of the soil, things sprout up and will naturally then cover more of this barren earth that you can see now. Hello, Matty. My good 9-year-old friend in Ohio, very happy to hear that you are with us. And you would like to know what the scorpions, especially the ground-dwelling scorpions, would have done after this rain, after their houses would have been flooded. I'm guessing, Matthew, they just sort of had to do some housekeeping, you know, empty out all the soil that got washed in, take out all their little millipede rings. It would have been a forced kind of spring clean of their little burrows, but nothing that they cannot handle. And because the earth is so dry at the moment, I'm sure it didn't take long for everything to be absorbed further below their burrows, deeper down into the water table. But I'm going to keep an eye out, Matty, for any scorpion homes, and if I find one, we'll be able to go in and take a closer look as to what exactly they've been doing. I haven't noticed any major activity from them. I'm trying to now scan the ground to find one. Obviously, Matty, you know that some of the scorpions we see live in trees. They would be in a better situation than the ones that live on the ground when it comes to rain. But even still, their little cracks in the trees may have become moist and waterlogged, but the scorpions can survive a little bit of moisture. So I don't think they would have had too much of a hard time, more just of an inconvenience more than anything else. Matty, I'm going to continue to try and find some scorpion burrows for you, but while I do that, we're going to send you across to James and some buffalo.
finally, our third buffalo sighting, and Kirsten has decided that these buffalo are worthy of hers and therefore your attention. Now, this is probably because they are sitting no more than 1.5 meters, or about 5 feet, from the vehicle. And they are loving the green shoots of grass that have come up as a result of the rain. They're in a state of ecstasy. You can hardly tell that, of course. They look like very morose creatures most of the time, but they certainly have a lightness about them. Now, I'm going to just sneak a little bit forward here so that you can get a really good look at them. And I think they've been lying in the mud at Treehouse Dam today. Look at this. This is wonderful. How close we are. And for much of the first part of this sort of time that I was here, every time I drove down this road, there were buffalo that had spent time in Treehouse Dam. They were coming along this area and grazing. And I think it's obviously a pretty nutrient-rich area, so if there is grass, I think the buffalo love it. How on earth they knew to come here, I guess, is just a function of the fact that they've learned. And they're grazing in amongst knobthorn trees and black gnome, in fact, largely black monkey thorn trees, which are very spiky indeed. Every so often you can see the buffalo sort of jerk its back out of the way. There's another one through there as well. I'm just gonna sneak forward again. There now, Dave, you can get them really savouring that green grass, and that'll probably be, could well be, that panicum species that I was talking about earlier. Likes to grow underneath acacia trees, because acacia trees are poor that make nitrogen-rich soil, which various kinds of grasses will really enjoy, and one of them is the panicum species. Highly nutritious. I'm just going to be quiet for a while. Just listen to their bodies moving through this woodland and their footfalls and the scrape of the thorns on their skin. Now, if you're walking in the bush, that is the kind of sound you would be listening out for. You'd listen for the scrape of the thorns on the skin, the heavy footfall. And that would indicate to you, of course, that there was a heavy animal nearby and that you should keep a sharp lookout. I'm going to sneak a little bit further forward again, and then we'll leave the old boys to themselves. Now, Elaine, it's a brilliant question that opens up all sorts of interesting discussion points to which I don't believe anybody really has the true answer. You want to know if there's already been damage to the grass sward, to the grass plants from overgrazing because of the drought. Elaine, no, I don't think permanent damage, no. Yes, there's been, I mean, if you just look over here, you can see there's hardly any grass at all there. Is that a permanent feature? No, it's not a permanent feature at all. But there are seeds there in the seed bed that won't grow unless there is a large rain and quite a lot of fertilization, which is quite interesting. I'm going to continue telling you about this. Scott's got a really colorful bird to show you though beforehand.
Well, this is the third and final component of the Juma bee eater trifecta. The little bee eater, the smallest of all the bee eaters we see, and it's a tiny, tiny little bird. It weighs only 15 grams, and from head to toe, or head to tail, rather, is only about 6 inches in length. So very, very small. And it'll have some mates around here. I'm not sure where they are. They usually fly around in small little family flocks. I think Brian has spotted another one. Aha, there we go. Well done, Brian. So that explains that there's at least two of them. And they are monogamous birds, so they form bonds. I think, oh, there's another youngster that just would have landed next to it there. Awesome, so we've got a whole little happy family here, it appears. But they're all flittering off in all directions now. Brian's doing a great job keeping track of them. How are those colours? You may notice a very slight turquoise mascara tinge on their eye. And if we were just a little bit closer, that would be more prominent, but that is one of their characteristics. And just like the carmine bee eaters that we saw flittering about earlier, they are incredibly good aerial pilots, being able to turn incredibly quickly on their wing as they hawk their prey. Oh, there you got a good example of just how quick they are. Let's have a look at them in the book so I can show you the other bee eaters that occur in the Kruger National Park. Hello, dear. Very happy to hear that you're enjoying all the different birds that we're seeing in your eyes. It's just phenomenal how quickly the rain has an impact. Sorry, not dear Mia. So, all the birds tweeting is making it difficult to hear who's who and what's what. So, the white-fronted bee-eater, you can see in the Sabi Sands, but it's usually in and around rivers. So I'm guessing that's why we haven't seen any. We're not close enough to the Sabi or the Sand River. Then as we move down, we get the little bee eater, which we've just been looking at here. The picture kind of depicts that little bit of turquoise mascara. Not well, though. That's why I don't really like bird books with pictures as opposed to photographs. Anyway, swallow-tailed bee eater. I've never seen any in the Kruger National Park. I don't think I've ever seen one in my life. Neither have I seen the blue-cheeked bee eater. Both very nice bee eaters, though, as you can see. And then as I flip over, we will see the other two species that we've already seen this afternoon. Glimpses of the European bee eaters flying past at the start of the safari. They're one of the trickier bee eaters to catch on film. And then the southern carmine bee eater, which we saw quite well with its youngsters, also feeding on the termites. Very good. So we have done the Juma trifecta. Those are the three bee eaters that we will readily see here. We are now, let me show you exactly where we are quickly before we head off. Sorry, Brian. Each time I move the vehicle ever so slightly, it changes camber, and Brian has to level the camera, so making extra work for him. All right, okay. For the new viewers, the square on the right, or rectangle on the right, is Juma. I'm not sure exactly where James is now, but he's somewhere on this property. We are the blue dots on Arethusa, which is this rectangle here, this kind of vertical rectangle, and I'm going to try and zoom in. The Anderson male moves along this whole western belt of Arethusa, but not much further east of my finger, to the right of where my finger is now. So that little thin strip of white is where the Anderson male tends to move. This is the buffer zone of his territory and Tingana. And Tingana pushes all the way to the right. Tingana moves all through this area, green below Juma, and then the entire portion of Juma has become Tingana's territory. That wasn't the case when I joined here in November 2014. So a good example of how territories are changing. I can show you guys exactly where James is now. He's on Philemon's cut line, so he's somewhere on this road over here. And we are across over there. So at least you know where he is in relation to us. And we're gonna now continue south along this little western border of ours and then along the southern boundary of Arethusa. So that's our route. And, oh, I've got a little, the visitor flew off. Anyway, we're going to continue along and send you back to James.
Now, we're coming along here, and I just want to try and find something quickly. And it's a thing that Mark, it is there. I can't believe this. Just zoom in on that hole there, if you don't mind. You won't believe what lives in there, everyone. Just keep watching. There's a crab living in there. Now, Mark Weiner, who used to work here for a long time, who passed master of a, you know, he really was a brilliant naturalist, or is still a brilliant naturalist. And he showed Scott once that there was a crab in there, and Scott in turn showed me that there was a crab. And I wondered if it could possibly have survived, given that this pan was completely dry for months. And just as we got in here, I saw it disappearing into that hole. And I don't think it's going to come out again. But we'll keep an eye out. As that water dries. Sorry about that. Isn't that cool? So that's a freshwater crab. I mean, it's not very cool for you at the moment because all you can see is a muddy hole. But I promise you, there is a crustacean that went wandering in there. Now, the other thing that I can hear are bee eaters, lots and lots of European bee eaters. And I suspect they are so high up in the sky that I can't see them. They'll also be trying to get hold of the termites. We're going to keep going along the road here and just see what we can find. And while we do that, Elaine, sorry, we were talking about overgrazing. And you were asking about long-term effects and could there be long-term effects. Elaine, it depends really entirely on your definition of what a long-term effect is. Could it affect the grass sward for the next decade? Yes, it could. Is that a bad thing? No, probably not, because it's a perfectly normal thing for us to have a drought. Will it change the suite of species here for the next 10 to 50 years? Yes, could possibly. Is that a bad thing, or is that a long-term damage? In the scheme of a human life, yes, it would be considered long-term. In the scheme of the life of this ecosystem, it's a blink of an eye. So it really depends on your perspective. From our human perspective, because we live for, you know, the time that we do, depending on how lucky you are, I suppose, between 70 and 100 years. Because of that, we tend to think of 20, 30, 40, 50 years as a long-term thing. Out here in this ecosystem, that's nothing. So it might well change the sward species completely for the next 50 years, might change the kind of animals that we have here. But in the long-term scheme of things, it's almost meaningless, I suspect. Just look, if you don't mind, panning onto the grass there, Dave. This was totally brown yesterday, totally brown. And you can just see a sheen of green. I know it still looks pretty brown in your picture, but you can just see a sheen of green that is running over the top of the grass sward. Now, the ultimate test, of course, as to what's going on with the grass is going to be these impala that we can see here. Now, the impala have been browsing highly enthusiastically for the last little while, not grazing anything because there hasn't been any grass. Let's just watch this rather terrifying group of males and see if they nibble any grass or if they're still bent on trying to find browse in the trees. There we go. Straight to the grass. Isn't that interesting? Haven't seen an impala grazing for the last 3 months. That's probably a bit strong. 2 months. Isn't that cool? All right, let's carry on. I've seen no tracks of any predator, I'm afraid, everybody. It's probably getting time to pop off to the hyena den and see what's over there. Now, Lael, in Washington, we were looking earlier at the borehole, or what you in the United States would probably call a well, and you want to know if we can drink that water. Yes, you can drink it. It's absolutely perfectly safe to drink. It just doesn't taste very nice. It tastes a bit like, it's quite salty. There's quite a lot of calcium in the soil, calcium salts in the soils here, and so it does taste a bit salty, and it leaves a salty residue if you boil it in a kettle or put it in a geyser or something like that. Then it will leave a salty residue. So we do drink, not bottled water, we drink treated water. You can buy enormous amounts of sort of cheap treated water, which isn't deleterious. It doesn't come in plastic bottles. It comes in great big sort of 5 gallon drums, and they're replaceable. So we do drink that water, which is much more delicious than the water that comes out of the tap here. Sometimes if you're really thirsty at night, though, you'll drink out of the tap. It doesn't have any effect on your stomach, though. I suspect, though, you know, as this drought wears on, the water will probably, it's starting to actually leave a bit of a brown residue in the basins, and I suspect that can't be particularly good for you, so whatever that is, you should probably avoid. Still not doing a marvellous job on the mammal frontier at the moment. I'm very jealous of the carmine bee eater. That is the Balanites tree, so named, or the road is named for it. Torchwood, Nicky Alston's favourite tree here. Very good climbing tree. You like to climb trees? I like to climb trees. David, do you climb trees?
I do.
Oh, there we go. I've just spotted another one of those Amur falcons. There he is, Dave. I'm not going to ask you to stick the camera on him yet. Just keep an eye on him. And if he comes towards us, see if I can catch up with him. They fly at a great speed, of course. There he goes. He's coming this way. I can't keep up with him, not without making you seasick. Let's carry on this way. I'm going to definitely go to the hyena den now. This is a zebra. Now, Susie, as we look at this lonely zebra in amongst the Cambrian woodland there, oh, excuse me. It was quite a sneeze with a bit of a whine in, thrown in. It's normally an alarm call, but he doesn't look too alarmed at all. Looks very happy. Susie, you want to know how on earth we identify the birds flying along so quickly and so easily? Well, Susie, it's not often that easy, but it's just a question of time. It took me a long time to do. I wasn't a bird watcher as a child, and so I learnt relatively late in life. It's just time. It's just learning the birds in an area. And I remember the day that I had exactly the same question for my trainer that you've just asked me. A bird flew overhead, flipped up into a tree, landed and disappeared from view in the foliage. And my trainer said, well, there goes a brown-hooded kingfisher. And I looked at this woman and I said, you must be mad. There's absolutely, that could have been an ostrich. There's no ways you could have told what that bird was flying at that speed into the bush and just disappeared. And she said, hey, don't worry, you will be able to do it. And you just get this this general impression, size and shape or guess of the bird, and that's how you figure it out. So I mean, you learn the way a hornbill flies with that loping motion. These are simple examples. You learn the way a kingfisher, when it goes, ooh, there's a lesser spotted eagle, which I missed, sitting right underneath. Hopeless, Hendry. Hopeless. It's just up ahead. We're going to try and sneak up there and have a look. David, I'm zebraed out. Let's go and see if we can find the lesser spotted eagle. He's just up ahead. I saw where he landed. So, Susie, it's just a question of time. You learn how these birds fly. You learn little tricks, the way that a woodpecker lands in a tree, the way that a kingfisher will fly towards a tree and then up into it. And eventually it just becomes kind of second nature. And I get the same feeling that you just got watching, you know, us identify birds with really impressive birders. They'll get half a call and identify the bird. Well, it's in this tree here, I think, David. Is it? No, there it is. It's up there. Just in the top of the foliage there. Don't fly. No, no, up. It's the dark, there he is. Dark patch in the middle. Up a bit. That's him. I think that's the lesser spotted eagle. Could be a brown-headed sparrow with that picture. I just thought it was lesser spotted from the mottling from the mottling of the feathers, and I know you saw one with Scott, and I was just very jealous. That's why I wanted to show you this one. I think that's what it is. Let's see if he flies as we go. Not going to get a good look in there, I'm afraid. Oh, well. Wonderful what these storms bring in. First one of the season. To answer this comment, but Michelle in Michigan, you say you want Scott to go to the hyena den because he calls them mammals? Let me just check that I've got that right. Because you'd prefer to see mammals, I see. Okay, well, we'll see if we can get there and find them. Not too far away now. A log lying in the bush. Now, we were driving through something called a seep line, and one of the interesting parts of the ecology of this area, while we're not looking at mammals, are these silver cluster leaf trees. And there's a beautiful grove of them here, and they grow on what we call a seep line. And a seep line is an area where there's some sort of subsurface soil barrier that doesn't allow the water to sink to the bottom, and when it rains, this area will become inundated with water. And it'll become very rich in good grazing grasses if we do get some decent rain going forward. Which we obviously hope for dearly. Let's head across to Scott, see if he's managed to find any mammals, and I'll see you at the hyena den.
Welcome back, everyone. And we've had a little bit of excitement. It could be us merely just getting ahead of ourselves, but we looked across. We're driving along the other side of this little riverbed that is flowing downstream in the direction of my hands. Yeah, there's no water in it at the moment, but there was some impala on this side of it. We were driving along the other side of it, and they just looked a little bit nervous. On top of that, we heard a squirrel alarm calling. We raced across onto the side of the riverbed and have yet to come up with anything. The squirrel stopped alarm calling, but there could be a leopard or some other predator nearby. I'm not sure whether the impala are merely responding to the alarm calls of the squirrel, hence showing their nervousness, or whether they can possibly smell the leopard or the predator that it may be. I'm guessing it is a leopard, if anything. That's what my money is on. But the bush here is quite thick, and the leopard could have slunk off or just merely be lying down in a spot where we may not be able to see it. The impala, we drove past the impala, they're going to be just up ahead of us. So we came racing up this way, checked a decent distance behind us, and then now I've turned around and I'm coming back in a little bit more of a civilized manner. We were racing as fast as we could to try and work out what was going on earlier. A herd of impala are now just up ahead of us. We'll get some visuals of them shortly. And it's just so important to read into the other animals, or any of the animals of this area, because their senses are so much better than ours. Let's see how these guys are looking. They seem okay. You see there's a little bit of nervousness. There's that male probably not helping things, giving the ladies a hard time. There is also a little bit of a breeze. So this breeze will be making them nervous. You may notice some of the trees and leaves blowing when the wind catches them. And wind will make the prey animals nervous because it'll muffle the sound
of a predator's approach. It'll also muffle or kind of distort any movement. So any bush that moves will help a moving predator, stalking predator, blend in better. Whereas if everything's dead still, obviously any movement as a predator takes a few steps will be easier to pick up. Maybe it was a false alarm, but it certainly was exciting coming across here. The squirrel was what kind of confirmed or gave us good reason to race across here on top of what looked to be quite nervous impala. The trouble we face, I mean, the leopard could be 10 or 15 meters away from us watching these impala now. And naturally, it doesn't want to be seen, so it's going to be flat to the ground, making it difficult for us to spot it, if it is in fact here. Kato Ray, you'd like to know when last were the wild dogs seen? Good question. I am not sure. Possibly 2-3 weeks ago. But maybe one of you guys can help us confirm when that was. I'm not sure. But it was a while now. It's been a fair couple of weeks, I'd say at least. I think the Investec pack of 11, 3 adults, 8 pups, are far north of us in the northern Manyeleti, close to one of the camps where we've got some friends that work, and they're on our WhatsApp group. So I read a report today that they are there, and the 8 remaining members of the Sands pack, is it 8 members remaining, I think? I'm not too sure. I'm not too sure on how many members of the Sands pack are remaining. I can find out now quickly. I'll just double check on that WhatsApp group. But they were seen in the southern Sabi Sands, the southwestern section of the Sabi Sands, not too far away. Investec pack close to there. And then there we go, I'm getting there. Okay, we last saw the dogs on the 12th of February, so quite a while back. So 5 pups are remaining in the Sands pack, and I just can't remember how many adults were in that pack anymore. Probably 5 or 6 adults in that pack, so I think there's about 10 or 11 of them remaining as well. And interestingly, the alpha male and female were mating a couple of days ago, apparently, so that's awesome news. They're already thinking about the next generation. They usually give birth in and around May. That's when they den. So if we're in the end of February now, March, April, May, 2.5-3 month gestation period, evidently. So that adds up. Let's hope that they decide to den on Juma. I'm not sure when last a pack of wild dogs did den on Juma, but it just means you are going to have an awesome, awesome 2 or 3 months. That's how long they will raise pups in a den for. The pups will start running with the pack and no longer rely on a den site once they're 3 months of age. But for those first 3 months, if you've got a den on your property, you are in the money, because you've got those adults that need to disperse from that den every morning to go hunting. And of course, you not only get to see them doing that, but you obviously get to see them returning to the den, regurgitating food for the pups, and obviously the cute, cuddly little pups as they grow up. I was lucky, my first 3 years as a guide in the Sabi Sands, wild dogs denned on the property that I traversed every single year, so I got spoiled. Subsequently, haven't been that lucky.
is. Matty! I am so happy that you have named a little pet iguana after me, and it's called Dyson. That really is the most awesome thing that I think I've ever heard in my whole life. So thank you for that, Maddie, and make sure you look after it. I don't want it getting injured or getting hurt, and I'm sure you will look after it, but it's a big responsibility to have a pet. So I remember also being young, I had all kinds of pets. I had hamsters, snakes, fish, scorpions, birds, big cages with birds outside my house. I also loved keeping animals, but it's a big responsibility. But I'm sure you are the perfect guy to be a good parent for that very cute little lizard. And thank you for naming it after me. That's the most awesome news I think I've ever heard. So thank you.
I'm told your mother didn't let you have a snake. Maybe when you're a little bit older, that will be possible. And don't worry, my mother also didn't let me have snakes when I was 9. I think I was maybe about 15 or 16 before she... I don't think she ever allowed it. I think I just did it and got into big trouble for it, Matty. But I would only suggest doing that in a couple of years' time. Awesome stuff. Matty, I have been looking for scorpion burrows. I haven't found any for you. There's one right here, right now. So, over my right shoulder here is a little scorpion burrow. There doesn't appear to be too much housekeeping that has been done. I can't see any soil piled up at the entrance, but that's not to say that the scorpion hasn't been busy, or maybe it was just lucky and it didn't get too much rain falling, or at least collecting in its burrow. Like I said earlier, maybe it's just that the ground is so thirsty and dry that it just got absorbed, straight through the burrow and further down into the ground. So there we go, we'll keep looking for some more that may be a little bit more active, and the next time you see us, I think we will be at the Arethusa waterhole, which is just ahead of us, but for now you guys are going to the hyena den.
My old favorite, here I am at the hyena den, and just in front of the car, which you cannot see, there is a small hyena, I think it is June, trying to remove the bull bar. So there she is. She took hold of the bull bar. Please don't look at that VR rig, because that is much too expensive. You can't afford a replacement. Do not. That's it. No. He's so sweet, and he's just smelling the air. Air is going from us to him. So he can smell human. She can smell human. Coming around the side. Hello. Isn't that sweet? Right, anyway, in front of us there, I think that's a male, if I'm not mistaken. I might be mistaken, but I wonder if that isn't one of the males that was herring around in the water today. I think it is a male. And he's certainly reticent about approaching the den. The cubs came out to greet him, and they were very happy to say hi to him. But he hasn't come anywhere closer than that. That's where he's kind of stayed. Now, who's this? It's definitely a female. I think that might be Corky, actually. And see the top of her head. Yeah, now, Tammy, I believe last night that you saw with Scott a hyena that was drooling from the mouth, sort of leaking from the eye, and looked in very bad shape. And nobody seemed to know what on earth was wrong with it. Tammy, we haven't seen that hyena again, and I couldn't possibly guess what was wrong. Safe to say that maybe it has either picked up a disease, could be something like rabies, but I think it's unlikely, or there's an infection from some kind of injury. Perhaps it's been bitten very badly. Maybe a snake even got hold of her. A snake bite like that, you know, neurotoxic venom could easily have an effect where that drooling would come. It might also, you know, it'll really kind of paralyze the nervous system and have horrible effects on the nervous system. So that could well be one of the effects of a neurotoxic venom, even on a large animal like a hyena. You see, the male's moved off. So he didn't want anything to do with the larger, more dominant female, and he's now moved off. All the little cubs came to say hi to him, and then he kind of backed off. Now, there he is. He's still there, but he's keeping his distance. And just the most brilliant sighting from this morning. See, look, he's just nervous. Bethany, you were watching this morning, and you were watching those two males with Sam. They were frolicking about in the water, having a gay old time. And you say that as soon as they got out, it looked like their fur was dry, and is there some kind of waterproofing on the fur? Bethany, there isn't, as far as I know. I think you'll find, though, that the fur is very matted. It's probably quite greasy, and it's probably relatively water-resistant. But no, they do get wet, and I mean, they swim purposely when it's cold, when it's hot. So they don't want fur necessarily to be water resistant. The male's now moved off. See, it's how sadly those little ones walked after him, as if to say, please don't go, let's play a little longer. But the female said, off with you, man. And that's June, I think, following on there. Could be her father. And whether she knows that or not, I don't know. Now, Kathy, you're a new viewer, and of course I do keep forgetting that I need to reiterate some of the stuff. You want to know how old the young ones are. Well, there are different classes of young ones. That biggest young one that was trying to eat the Land Rover was born in June last year. That's why she's called June. These two little things that you're looking at now were born in December. They're called D1 and D2. D1 is the one with the little left hind foot that has a white patch on it, and that's a female. That's her there. And that's a little male born in December as well. D2, and that, if I'm not mistaken, is their mother, Corky. I can't see the top of her head, though. I think that's her. No, it's not. It's not Corky. I don't know who that is. She has got one set of ruffled ears, but I don't think that's Corky, so I'm not sure who that is. Anybody who knows, please send through. We've got some wonderfully brilliant guests, at least brilliant viewers, who are excellent at identifying these hyenas. So I can't tell who that is, to be honest. And then there are another two very small ones. Another two very tiny ones that were born in January. Now, Kirsten says to me she thinks that is Corky. Kirsten, I'll tell you why I don't think so. She doesn't have those scars between the ears, on the top of the ears. She's got one, obviously, very mangled left ear, but she doesn't have that scarring between the ears. So I would say not. Unless this is the scar-backed female. Ah, you know what, David, can you just go back onto that one there, on the ground there, hind end underneath where she's lying on the ground. Now, if you look carefully, you can see a scar there. It's grown over since it was last obviously seen. I think that's the scarback female, which would be June's mum. Here comes June now, to the right-hand side. That's who I think that is, but I'm happy to take any kind of advice from our hyena experts. She is just totally fearless. Hello. Now sitting on the door looking at her, trying to see what she's going to do. Do not take anything from the wheel. Oi. Oi. Extremely naughty hyena. Hey, she's ignoring me completely. Terrified she is. See her running away. I don't think these new Land Rovers actually have oil caps. No, they do. They have got oil caps. These, what these hyenas will do is walk up to the wheel and pull the oil cap off and remove it back into the den. And then suddenly you've got oil leaking all over the place. And although they do rest, they don't sleep soundly like lions do, for example. So she's always up and looking around. Joni, interesting question. Why did I think that that hyena was male? Joni, here he's still there. A few reasons. Firstly, the fact that he was kind of staying away from the females. Secondly, that he doesn't have teats, and all of the females that I know in this clan have got cubs. And you can see that, that this hyena definitely doesn't have teats that are the same size. Also, and interestingly, here he comes. If you look at a hyena's penis, or pseudo-penis in the case of a female, the male's is normally pinched off, and the female's is normally kind of very straight. Now, let's just look here. Now, you can't really see on that one. Do you see how nervous he is? Yes, it is. It is pinched off at the front. So I would say that's a male. And of course, the males, Joni, are very subordinate to the females. And look how excited the little ones are to see him. Isn't that sweet? And look how patient he is with them. Much more patient than a strange female would be. I wonder if he isn't the father. It's almost like they hardly ever see him, and he's here now, and so they're going to make the most of it, which I think is just rather sweet. June's going to say hi too. Yeah, that's definitely a male. You can see now, end of his penis is quite pinched off. Some of our viewers will be able to tell you exactly which male that is. I haven't got to that level yet, I'm afraid. This is so cool. Cat in Tampa, a very interesting question. Of course, some of you will not know, of course, that hyena have very strange kind of male and female organs, the only ones in the mammal kingdom that have a situation like this, where a female has an enlarged pseudo-penis, which is in fact an enlarged clitoris, but into which the, what's it called, it's the urinary tract, is kind of merged. And so, Kat, you want to know if she has a separate opening for urinating out of? No, she doesn't. She will urinate out of the pseudopenis. She'll even give birth out of it, with the result that a lot of young hyenas giving birth for the first time will die in cub birth, if you like. Now, David is actually zoomed in on the hyena, which is about to climb into the passenger seat. That's June. I don't think she can do any damage there, so we'll let her be. And they're the other two little ones with who I think is probably their father. Now look how he moves off. As soon as the female gets up, now she's chasing him. She just took two fast steps towards him and he went away. Totally subordinate to the females, or all the males. I just think it's fascinating how keen they are to spend some time with him. The little ones really want to kind of greet him and spend a bit of time with him, and he's so patient with them. He's totally tolerant of their activities. Miss Lynn, are you making a statement that he's probably the son slash uncle? I think probably referring to the fun uncle. Oh, I see. Okay, yes, that makes much more sense. He could be the fun uncle. I think he's probably the father, though. That would be my guess. And he's been told to slink off into the darkness. Now, while they're a little bit away, I just want to sneak a bit closer because I think those little ones are about to come out if they haven't already. Just need to find out how to start the car, of course. They'll come now. There, now we can look at any side. But over to this side. Sorry, Kirsten, I removed your communications for a little while there. Would you go again with that, please? Hello. You are very sweet. Now, Virginia, you want to know why June's fur over here? That's June there, David. Her fur looks thicker and lighter than these other two. Well, Virginia, that's a very good question. The other two, of course, have just lost their black fur from being tiny little cubs, and so they will inevitably be slightly darker than she will. She's is quite a light hyena. Hyenas will have some variation in their colour, of course. And but they are fluffier. All the youngsters are more fluffy than the older ones. And as they get to that age, their hair kind of reaches a maximum length. Yeah, there's the little one, Dave. There, just behind the tree. You can just see it standing there. Come on. Now, here comes an adult to do some disciplining. They're so sweet, those little ones. I think there's definitely some motivation to be had for putting a camera at this den if they're going to use it for any length of time. There are some fascinating things going on here all the time. So those ones we call, those two little ones we call the January babies, January 1 and 2. I haven't found a way to tell them apart just yet. So sweet. So their mother, who is the matriarch of this clan, will be up top there. I suspect that's her, sort of, who's just stood up and is greeting them. I think the other one... I think the other one is probably pretty. Let me just get my powerful binoculars out again. Oh, dear. I hope I haven't lost them. Here they are. Yeah, that very good-looking, pristine-looking female there, I think, is pretty, probably. And she is the mother of November, who we haven't seen yet this afternoon. She was born in November, obviously. And that is the matriarch with the others. So I think we're getting a handle on things here at the hyena clan. There's a wonderful Facebook group called the Hyenas of Juma and Arethusa, so check that out. There's some incredible information that our viewers have put up there. It's just fantastic. Now, Andrea, a nice question about Siblicide. Now, Siblicide, for those of you who don't know, is also known as Cainism, after Cain, who wasn't so kind to his brother Abel and killed him. And Andrea, it does happen, and you read that it only happened when they were cubs of the same sex, and now you hear also that it can happen in cubs of different sexes. It can happen in cubs of different sexes, the same sex. It doesn't seem to matter. For a long time, we thought it was only females that would kill each other, but it seems to be that it will be female on male, and sometimes male on male too. But normally females who are imbued with much more testosterone. I have got two hyenas basically sitting on my lap now. Hello? Me. retrieve my telephone and take a picture. You will not believe. Oh, that's interesting. So, Michelle, in Michigan, you reckon that hyena that we saw now, the male, was the sick one from yesterday. Now, that would make sense for two reasons. Firstly, when hyenas are sick or when they're upset or if they're in trouble or injured, they will come back to the den. The males will come back to the den and seek out kind of protection from the rest of the clan. So that would make sense. If he had been bitten by a snake or something like that, he would have come back here to convalesce. And I wonder if that isn't precisely what's happened. So, Michelle in Michigan, thank you very much for that. Perhaps it was a snake that injured him. He came back here, spent a day, and he's worked the poison through his body, which is not unusual. That's entirely possible with animals like this, especially with the constitutions of a hyena, for them to work through what could be a very kind of dangerous poison for a human being or dangerous venom for a human being. And then, Dave, just quickly, sorry, up at the top there, November's just come out of the den, so I think that is definitely pretty. There, you can just see there. So all seem to be present and accounted for, unless that's one of the D's. Now, that might be one of the D's. They're so cool. David, would you like to answer Teresa's question? How did you feel about hyenas being so close to you?
I fear more for lions.
You fear more for lions. Yes, there's something about a lion that is inherently more terrifying.
Can you see that picture, James?
Yes, let's have a look at the picture. I was just trying to get it into a state where it was viewable. There. You see? The hyena was that close to the car. And that's them talking now. You can hear them going, hey, just quickly look here, look here, look here, look. Just leaning on the log there. All right, let's head across to Scott. He's got something really interesting to show you. I'm going to stay here for the next little while.
So, our search on the far western reaches of Arethusa has not been completely fruitless. Take a closer look of where we are now. Let me just zoom out slightly. You can see we are in the southwesternmost corner that we can traverse on Arethusa, and take a look at what we found. I'm just going to hop out quickly. We found some big, big male leopard tracks. They could be Tinganas, but they also could be the Anderson males. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to shine the torch from a side angle, that way casting an angle, better shadows on 1, 2, 3, 4 toes, the back pad. There's another one further forward that I'm going to try and show you. Over here, this one might be a little bit better. And again, look at this, how well the torch works if it simulates early morning sun at a low angle as opposed to midday sun. Tracking in the middle of the day, not easy. Tracking in the early morning or late afternoon, much better, much easier to see the tracks. Now, I can tell that these tracks are from early this morning because the soil was still moist when he walked here. And the reason I can tell that is that parts of it have caked. It's quite hard and crumbly to touch. I'm not sure if you would have been able to see that, but you'll just have to trust me. Even here, you can look at these little, almost little bricks that have been a result of moisture solidifying, and they're portions of the track that have those kind of solid little feelings, and as soon as you touch them, they then powder. So, not very fresh, but at least we did find some sign of a big male leopard in our search for him. Sadly though, we've driven that whole western boundary with no sign of him, so not too sure where he could have gone. He could have gone further west into the neighboring property. Whichever one it was, Anderson or Tingana, we will never know.
Some of you may remember a sighting we had of Tsingana vocalizing, straight facing, straight down the camera, only a few meters from the vehicle. That was the same afternoon we found Tsingana walking along this road and to where the tracks are here, and then continued up along the road we've come on. So happy memories and a good example of how leopards will like to follow set pathways. I have also on many occasions found big male leopard tracks at this road junction. And that's because the chances of finding leopard tracks are good here, because two males check this area. It's a boundary between their territories, therefore increasing your likelihood of seeing tracks on a border where not one but two animals may move. Wunderbar. Eric, you are hoping that we could furnish you with some happy tales of leopard cubs. Sadly, not looking pretty on that front. I'm convinced that Karula has no longer got cubs. She did at least have one. There was one confirmed visual of her tiny little furball with Brent about 3 weeks ago, but since then her behavior has not been indicating that she still has cubs. So I feel strongly that she's been unfortunate. Possibly for the third time in a row. I think she could have had two litters last year that we were simply unaware of. They will mate very quickly after losing cubs to try and get the next cubs into the system. And the fact that she lost her last confirmed cub, I think in February last year, she would have easily had enough time to mate, give birth, lose cubs, mate, give birth, lose cubs, without anyone actually knowing. And this is the third time, again, hypothetically speaking, where at least we know for certain that she did have a cub that was lost. There was also speculation of her daughter Shadow having cubs. Again, her behavior not indicative of that, of a leopardess that has cubs. So we're going to have to wait for our two ladies to try again. There are many other leopard cubs in the Sabi Sands, just simply where we cannot go. To the south of us, there are, or at least the last time I heard, there was a female, I've forgotten her name now. What's her name? Anyway, in the western section of the Sabi Sands, can't remember her name, but she's got three little cubs, and that's uncommon for a leopard to be successfully raising three cubs. Usually it's two. Brent was lucky enough to see Inkanyeni, a leopardess that is to the east of us on Torchwood. So neighbors, but I've never seen her. She's got two cute little cubs that I think are about 3 months old now. Brent was lucky enough to see them a couple of days back while he was traversing the property east of us. So they are around, but just not on our property. Our luck will change, though. We just have to be patient. Good. We're going to send you back to the hyena den. There's probably not too much time that can be spent there with this fading light, so go and make the most of it.
Just listen to them calling. It's two females. What is it? Fascinating stuff. Everyone is here, by the way. I definitely saw November. So the two D's and the two J's. And everyone is here. Oh, another fascinating time here. I think this is a good time to leave everyone. I don't want to be here after dark. And just quickly to show you once more, the male is off to the side there on his own, observing. There he is. I think that's him. Can't see anymore. I can barely see that hyena. You're basically looking at him through the enhanced light that the camera gives. What? Yet another wonderful sighting here. Let's pull out and see what else we can see in the last half an hour. Perhaps a cat stalking the plains, perhaps not much. Of course, we can't move right now because June is sitting behind the car. June, gear off. That was just fantastic. There isn't anything behind us, is there, David?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. I think what we'll do from here is drive down just to around where we last had those tracks of the leopard and just see if she isn't perhaps coming out of hiding somewhere. She may have had a kill of some sort for the last 2 days, and let's see if we can't find her popping out to have a drink. I know that the Juma Dam pan cam is not quite up to scratch at the moment. In fact, it's not working at all. And we'll just drive past there and see if she isn't going to have a drink, and then we'll head down Twin Dams Road, and perhaps we will be lucky. Spotlight out. And we won't shine light on those hyenas just yet. I think they would need to be at least sort of a year old before we'd be prepared to stick a light on them. If they're adults, they don't seem to mind. Well, I mean, they don't mind at all. But we just don't want to put them at any kind of unfair disadvantage. Check my comms quickly. Thank you, Deborah, Entree Traveller. You say that June didn't want me to leave. No, well, you know, June and I have a special relationship. I'll show you, while you were gone, she came right up to the car and I stuck my phone over the side of the car. She didn't react, she just kind of looked at it. And she, at one stage, I was a little bit nervous she was going to take it in her jaws and remove it. But she didn't do that. So we've got a really nice close-up of her. Get out of here. David, do you see how squashed against the steering wheel I am?
Oh, yes.
Yes. That is for your benefit, of course. Never felt like a dwarf before I came to work here. See what creatures of the night we can find. I still hope one day very much to see a civet live. Their tracks are all over the place in the mornings, but come the night, there's just nothing to see, civet-wise. Bush babies, quite a few around. Chameleons also. Genets, perhaps. Leopards, with any luck. Perhaps the odd owl as well. That would be fun. Oh, kingfisher. There's a kingfisher just there we go. And he's just hiding there. And the kingfisher, of course, this woodland kingfisher, is not shy to keep yelling throughout the night, making the most of the little bit of time that they have to breed. And I think probably looking for insects. Yes, hawking insects out of the air that are coming to the light now. So that's why they'll be around the water. There's a little pan here on the left, right-hand side, you can see there. And the kingfisher will be hanging around here for the insects that are lurking around the water. That's very clever. Let's head back across to Scott to see what he's doing. There's a little termite in my view, and I'll see if I can find something in the interim.
like to take off in an airplane. This is, I think, the closest I'm going to come. Well, at least while I'm piloting. So, we are on the Arethusa International Airstrip. And we are slowly making our way back towards Juma. Who knows what will happen along the way? I'm hoping that the African rock python that I was speaking of earlier is going to slither across the road for us. That would be a great way to finish off what's been an enjoyable evening spent on safari with all of you. Who knows, maybe we'll get lucky and get a little bit more rain tonight. A little bit of wind picking up, cloudy skies. So, good prospect with a bit of moisture. And I'm told you're getting a good idea of how windy it is from my microphone. Maybe I can try and put it somewhere a little bit more protected. Okay, can you still hear me? Hello? 1, 2, 1, 2. Okay. Very good. Oh, no, it's popped out again. I'm going to have to do my buttons up here. Feels like I'm going to a wedding. Hey, Michelle in Michigan. You would like to see a big African rock python and two of the cobra species we get here. So one would be the Mozambican spitting cobra, the other would possibly be the snouted cobra, formerly known, I believe, as the Egyptian cobra. Yeah, there's equal chances of seeing all of them. Maybe the greatest chance of actually seeing a snake or out of those three would probably be the Mozambican spitting cobra. I think I've seen more of those than any others, although I've only managed to, I think, get one on camera, and it was a tiny little one. Some of you may remember. We even managed to get it to flare up its little hood and display for us. That was so cute. It was absolutely minute, that one. So it is possible, Michelle, but the Mozambican spitting cobra is, interestingly enough, like infrastructure. So we tend to find them in and around the camps quite often. Probably the snake that I've caught more than any other to remove from guest rooms whilst working in the Sabi Sands. Always a thrilling call to get over the radio. Scott, there's a snake in your guest room. And then you grab the snake tongs, a long kind of pole with a tong action at the end. And you can quite safely, you know what you're doing, catch snakes with those tongs at a safe distance and remove them back into the wilderness. We'd also take a big visor, clear visor, in case it was a Mozambican spitting cobra that would always spit at you. But thankfully, if the spit just lands on your skin, nothing will happen unless you've got a gaping wound that the venom gets into, then it could cause a little bit of trouble. Quite refreshing, actually, being spat on by a cobra. I don't think it's something that many people can say has happened to them. Reminds me of a very interesting sundowner stop one evening where I parked the vehicle at a small waterhole, and myself and my tracker, James Mdaga, were, this was before he got run over by a buffalo, or at least attempted to run over by a buffalo, we were setting up a drink stop. And every time I walked past a bush, I felt this kind of moisture, and I kept looking up thinking, is a bird peeing on me? What is going on? Until the third time I walked past the bush, I realized that the moisture was hitting me from a horizontal angle, not from above. That's when I froze in my tracks and realized that there was a Mozambican spitting cobra coiled up in a spindly little bush, kind of like this on the right here, but a little bit shorter. I mean, a small little bush. So it had nowhere to escape. And every time I walk past, I thought, and it would spit at me. Ended up being a great sundowner, because once we established where the snake was, I put my Ray-Ban aviators on. Those are my sunglasses back then. And I did a little demonstration with the guests. Got it out the tree with a long stick. Got it to flare its hood. You would not believe what luck we are in. Speaking of which, here is a snake in the tree. It is a boomslang. Can you believe it? Well, let's get into a slightly better position. Epic! Second boomslang for the day. And it's not the same tree, nor is it the same boomslang. But this is a big female. We'll be able to get a good view of her eye, her massive eye. Look at this. Beautiful. Now, I'm not sure. James was convinced the one that he was looking at this morning was a male. He was disagreeing with Georgianne in Illinois. Georgianne, I was on your side. We still haven't got completely to the bottom of it. We've done as much research as possible. But basically, they have varying shades, depending on age, depending on the area you find them in. In my history of viewing boomslang in the Sabi Sands, the males have always been a lime green color, and the females have always been this brownish color. Oh, she's looking right at us now. Look at this. So I think it's a female, and I also thought the one this morning was a female. The males, like I said, will be a beautiful lime green, emerald green rather. And interestingly, in different parts of South Africa, further south of us along the coast, the males will be black, yellowy green colors, all mottled. So a variety of different colors. James says I'm throwing him under the bus, but like I said, I cannot be 100% certain that I am correct. But oh, look at her tongue sniffing the air. A scent so important to them. As I was saying though, I'm not convinced that James is wrong. I'm just merely offering my opinion, so I'm not categorically stating that, but opening up a discussion where it may turn out that he could well be wrong, and it could turn out that I may well be wrong. So ooh, look at how quickly she can move that head of hers. Now, this is one of the most venomous snakes in South Africa, but I'm completely relaxed, parked about a meter away from her for a couple of reasons. They are not notorious biters, and they are back-fanged, rear-fanged, which is a reason why they are not notorious for biting, because they know that their bite is probably not going to have a huge effect on us. They need to almost chew onto their prey in order to envenomate them. So often if you are bitten by a boomslang, you can hope that it may be a dry bite where the fangs do not actually manage to envenomate you, or you could be in deep trouble. Hemotoxic venom, which will attack your blood, you could bleed out, or you could have just internal hemorrhaging. Awesome, awesome stuff. I'm guessing she's about 4 feet in length, maybe 3.5 to 4 feet in length. I don't know, Brian, hey? Hard to say with her all coiled up differently. Okay, so Brian's in agreement with me. Marianne in New York, you loving her big eye, and that is one of the biggest distinguishing, Monique, that is one of the biggest distinguishing features of the boomslang. It is that they do have this massive eye. Oh, there we go. That's the eye we talked. Oh, sorry, Brian, I ambushed you there with some movement, and now we can't even see ahead anymore. I just thought I'd roll back ever so slightly to get us a bit of view, but that backfired. Anyway, she does have a big eye, bigger than most snakes, and
That is a good way to be able to know that it is actually a boom slung, not something else. Well, we're going to leave her to it. Awesome stuff. I hope you all enjoyed that. They're not nocturnal snakes, so we're not going to see her moving around too much. James Baird, you'd like to know if we bring the guests a new set of underwear when we come to catch snakes. And sadly not. That is up to them. Now, something I'd just like to show you quickly is what to look for when looking for snakes in trees, similar to scorpions. I mean, you can quite clearly see that something is amiss there, even from far. I mean, that is not a branch. That is something that sticks out like a sore thumb. To me, I don't know if you guys agree. So those are the obscurities you're looking for when you're driving around at night. Oh, it looks like she is on the move now. That's probably because of our presence and the fact that we have lit her up. So we are going to leave her to her business before an owl swoops down and consumes her. She's not very well concealed out on those dead branches. She obviously thought it was safe to slither out there once darkness fell, but it would not be a tip. It's not actually a typical place. I was surprised to see out there. They usually would conceal themselves in thicker vegetation. Well, Rocky Knight, you are amazed, but don't be. That was quite easy to spot, like I say, and as I showed you guys afterwards, not hugely difficult to spot, no different to chameleons. It's one of those things that guests always are so fascinated by when their tracker spots a chameleon, or often it's the guide who spots it, tells the tracker in the local language, and then the tracker pretends to spot it. That's often what happens. Basically though, again, like chameleons, because it is an animal that has got such good camouflage during the day, at the outset you would think, yes, this is a miracle that somebody has spotted it, but it's actually easy once you know what to look for. So it's one of those guiding things that everyone gets credit for that you actually shouldn't, and then you do like a miraculous tracking exercise where you track and find a leopard or a pride of lion, which requires a lot more skill, and your guests just sit there going, you know, not too impressed by it. So it's just some behind the scenes interesting tales of what impresses guests is actually often not what requires skill, and what does require skill doesn't really fascinate them. Okay, well, before taking you any further down this very bumpy road, we are going to say goodbye and thank you for joining. Well done, Brian, on camera. Well done to Kirsty and Leanne and Louise in the final control room. And of course, well done to Mr. Henry, who's been on the other vehicle with Dave. We're going to send you over to him now for him to say goodbye, and we will see you on the Sunrise Safari along with Sam. Don't forget, there's going to be Sam taking a drive tomorrow. Toodaloo.
Sure that saying well done to me is necessarily a good idea from Scott, but very kind of him. I've now driven around for the last almost half an hour with the spotlight. I saw one leaf that looked a bit like a chameleon, but otherwise, nothing. Nothing. David, is it you or is it me? Given that I was with VM today and saw about the same this morning, it must be me. One does hope things will improve. There's a very pleasant wind now blowing out of the northwest. Now that is an excellent wind if we're for a storm. And there is some lightning there. So perhaps we will have a storm like we had yesterday evening. It was just wonderful. But otherwise, don't hold out much hope that in the next 60 seconds I'm going to find something awesomely spectacular to extend the show by an hour, because it is so magnificent in its fascination that we couldn't possibly go offline. 40 seconds to do that, David. What do you think it'll be? Maybe be a caracal steaming across the plains chasing a duiker or a steenbok. Nope, nothing. All right, everyone, that's it from us tonight. Big thank you to David for your efforts today. Thank you, David. To Scott, of course, I think a much better well done, and he was, of course, being filmed by Brian Joubert. And thank you to Kirsten on the Vox and Leanne on the keys. And mostly, thank you to all of you for your questions and conversation during the course of the afternoon. It's been wonderful. We'll see you tomorrow at 05:30. Bye-bye.